Just love listening to David Smalley and the Dogma Debate.
What you are about to hear is like nothing you've heard before.
This isn't just about debating. This is about making a difference.
It'll challenge you. It'll make you laugh. It'll upset you. But most importantly, it'll make you make.
I actually have proof here.
We just created a gay baby.
You're all dirty little heathens.
Here we go. Welcome to the Dogma Debate. I'm your host, David Smalley. Today is a very special episode of the Dogma Debate, specifically because it's actually a debate. It's not just your average radio show this time. We're going to be talking about the proposition, is there sufficient evidence to believe in the God of the Bible? Do you believe there is sufficient evidence? And we have two people here to offer their sides of this debate, and I'm very honored to have both of them on. The man representing the Christian apologist side of this argument is a guest who we've had on the show before. His name is Eric Lounsbury. He's a Christian apologist and creator of two Bible games, one called Inklings and another called Babel. He's debated the likes of Dan Barker and George Smith, with apparently very good results. His opponent is no stranger to most of the listeners of Dogma Debate. In fact, I believe the fourth listeners may consider him one of the first three. His name is Matt Dillahunty. He's a former Christian who was on his way to the ministry, is a sought-after speaker in the atheist movement, and the host of the Atheist Experience TV show, sponsored by the Atheist Community of Austin, where he served as president for more than 7 years. This debate is going to happen as follows. Each person is going to get a 10-minute opening statement. Then we're going to take a very short break like we typically do on the show. When we come back, each person is going to get a 15-minute rebuttal. After that break, then we're going to have another 15-minute cross-examination, and then another 15-minute cross-examination, and then we will take listener questions. Now, if you want to get your questions in, do not call right now. We're not going to take calls until the question and answer section comes up. And that will be the phone number. Go ahead and get ready. Get your pen, if people still use those for taking down phone numbers. The phone number is 214-377-1166. 214-377-1166. You can also live tweet your questions at David C. Smalley. I'll be checking Twitter at David C. Smalley as well as answering the calls. Now, I'll be honest with you here. I'm not going to be screening the calls because there's not going to be time. So when you call in, you're going to be live on the air the second you hear us. So 214-377-1166, but be sure to wait until it's actually time, and I will announce before the commercial break, I will announce exactly when we'll be taking the calls. All right, let me go ahead and just say hello to each one of the folks here. Hello, Eric. How are you doing today, sir?
I'm doing very well. Thank you for asking, David.
Thank you for joining us today, and hello, Matt Dillahunty.
Hey, David. Thanks for having me.
I really appreciate both of you guys doing this today, and both of you know that it's very important to Dogma Debate that we have a peaceful, a respectful approach moving forward. We present our cases with as much respect to the other person as possible, and this is always about continuing dialogue, continuing the conversation, but inspiring others to continue to have civil discourse about what other may consider very controversial worldviews, and I'm sure both of you will agree to that.
Absolutely.
Sure.
Fantastic. All right, well, let's go ahead and get it started. I am starting the timer now. Eric Lounsbury will go first. Your 10-minute opening statement. Eric, go ahead.
Thank you, David. Okay, as the one who is taking the positive in this debate, having to present the evidence for the existence of God, what I'm going to do is I'm going to present a series of premises that I believe show strong evidence for the existence of God, and then I will give evidence that this God that exists is the God of the Bible. So, beginning with the premises, premise number one, existence does not come from non-existence. The proof of this is the truth of this premise is evident. The idea of attributing an effect to a non-existing cause is absurd. Example, if a fire broke out in a room that I happen to be in and someone present asked what caused it, and I reply, the fumes from the gasoline can must have ignited by the candle's flame. The problem is, there's neither a candle nor a can of gasoline existing in this room. Therefore, it is impossible for the existence of the fire in the room to have come from the non-existing gasoline and candle. The second piece of evidence that proves this is the principle of uniformity, which states that similar effects have similar causes. Every single example we have of something beginning to exist shows that it came from something already existing. Premise number two, something exists. If you want to argue this premise, you have bigger problems than we can solve with this debate. Premise three, something is eternal. The proof of this follows logically from premise one and two. If existence does not come from non-existence and something exists, then something must necessarily be eternal. Otherwise, at some point, existence came from non-existence, which is absurd. Premise number four, the universe is not eternal. Proof of this comes from the evidence of the expanding universe, evidence for the radiation echo, the laws of thermodynamics, and hot spots in the universe, and also there's nearly universal acceptance in the scientific community regarding this premise. Professor Krauss stated it clearly in his debate with a Muslim. You can hear that here.
The point is, the universe, our visible universe, did have a beginning because we can measure it. Whether we liked it or not, or whether we think it's sensible or not, it actually did have a beginning, a cause, not a factor not in dispute.
Next, the fifth premise is, whatever is eternal transcends the universe. The proof of this is, one, it follows necessarily from premises three and four. If something is eternal, but it is not the universe, then whatever is eternal must have existed prior to the universe, and would therefore transcend the universe. Secondly, listen again to Professor Krauss as he states that on the basis of evidence, he believes the universe was likely brought into existence and an eternal transcendent cause was the reason. Krauss and I both agree on that. We simply disagree on what the cause was. Here's Professor Krauss.
My opponents might argue that the multiverse, which our universe might have spontaneously been created in, was created by physicists because they don't like God, because it's eternal and exists outside our universe, the same characteristics that God is supposed to have. But it wasn't created because we don't like God, although I don't like God. We've been driven to it by measurements. In fact, I don't even like the multiverse, but I've learned to force my beliefs to conform to the evidence of reality.
So notice Professor Krauss admits that the evidence indicates that there is an eternal transcendent cause of the universe. We just disagree on what that cause is. Premise number six, whatever is eternal is the source of all things created. The proof for this is that anything created must ultimately come from that which is eternal. Otherwise, at some point, existence would have come from non-existence, which is absurd. Premise number seven, whatever is eternal is the source of all power existing. Again, the proof of this is that if the premise were not true, then at some point a certain measure of power would have been brought into existence by non-existence, which again is absurd. Premise number eight, whatever is eternal is intelligent. The proof of this is the principle of uniformity. Again, this principle teaches us that similar effects have similar causes. Some effects can have practically an unlimited number of causes, while other effects will have a significantly limited number of causes, and still others will only have one cause. The principle of uniformity reveals only one known cause for the origination of the type of functional specified complexity we see in the simplest living cell, and that cause is intelligence. In another debate, when asked if he was walking along a beach and he saw spelled out in seashells the words, I love you, would he believe that they had an intelligent origin? Matt had this to say.
That said, there are plenty of examples of people seeing messages in things that clearly weren't designed. Now, when you look at this and you conclude there's a designer, you're making a decision about what's most rational and you...
Okay, and again, let me have you hear this.
Of walking along a beach and finding I love you spelled out there, of course you are going to recognize that as design. The question is, why and how do you recognize it as design? And it's not because it's complex. It's not because you merely intuit or use common sense. You use the intuition and common sense that is built on the experience. And experience comes from contrast. All of the available evidence points to I love you being spelled out in seashells as consistent with design that we recognize. We see people do this. We know we do this. We have no evidence to support the idea that this is going to happen without this. However,
okay, so finally, putting together what we have learned from these premises exists that is eternal, transcendent, created. It's also all-powerful or attributes of the God of the Bible. It also eliminates the idea of any other quote-unquote God existing if that God does not possess these attributes. So it is true when atheists claim that science has eliminated thousands of gods, yet while it has eliminated thousands of other gods, it has illuminated one. I contend that that God is the God of the Bible. For my next bit of evidence, what I'm going to do is give testimony to the suppressing life of the atheist and show how the things that an atheist suppresses in his own heart and mind give evidence to the existence of God. One, the atheist has to suppress an inner testimony telling you that there is a God. As a matter of fact, both Lawrence Krauss and Matt have gone on record saying that they believe that men are hardwired to believe in the existence of God. They simply blame it on evolution, tricky evolution. The second thing that they suppress, Richard Dawkins, in a discussion with Lawrence Krauss here in Phoenix, said that when it came to free will, when asked if he believed in free will, Lawrence Krauss said, "It is a question I dread. I have a materialist view of the world. Things are determined in a rational way by antecedent events. That commits me to the view that when I think I have a free will, when I think I'm exercising free choice, I am deluding myself. My brain states are determined by physical events. Yet, that seems to contradict, to go against, the very powerful subjective impression that we all have, that we do have a free will. A free will is what you would expect in a Christian worldview. It is certainly not what you would expect in an atheistic worldview. The next thing an atheist must suppress, you must suppress the incredibly powerful urge to ascribe moral culpability to people who commit every form and type of evil, from child molestation to rape and murder. The next thing, you must also engage in a war against any type of guilt you might feel. After all, guilt is only legitimate if you could have done otherwise. Physicalism denies such an ability exists. No matter how hard and loudly your heart and mind may be screaming otherwise, you have to deny it. And finally, you have to suppress that inner testimony that you and your family and others have an intrinsic value that is no greater than a dog or a chicken or even a roach. Of course, all of these things that an atheist must suppress make perfect sense if the God of the Bible exists.
Thank you, Eric. He's a little bit under time, so Matt, at this point, rather than doing a rebuttal now, it is time for your 10-minute opening. Go ahead.
All right. Thanks, everybody, for being here. Is there sufficient evidence to believe in the God of the Bible? Once upon a time, there was a rationally justified belief that the sun orbits the Earth. It's one of the clearest examples I can think of where a position was both rationally justified based on the available information and understanding of the time, and yet ultimately false. Even those who might hypothesize that the Earth was spinning initially had no foundation for arguing this. You could look up and see the sun moving across the sky. We could observe what happens when you spin objects. Why didn't we fly off? And with no understanding of gravity, the universe looked very different. Ultimately, we realized that this position wasn't rationally justified, and then we realized that it was simply wrong. We had a belief, we investigated, we learned that we simply didn't have good reasons to think it was true, and then we reached a model that demonstrated it was false. That hasn't stopped people from arguing for a geocentric universe. Even to this day, there's a new film out that argues on behalf of this position again. But when it comes to the claim that a God exists, or that the God of the Bible exists, as we're debating today, I'm not convinced that belief was ever rationally justified, but I'd argue that it certainly isn't rationally justified today, even if we never reach the point where we have a clear model that demonstrates that it's false. There's a default position when we're talking about rational beliefs. Do you believe every claim until it's proved false, or do you disbelieve, withholding your acceptance of the proposition, until it's demonstrated that you're rationally justified to accept it? The former puts us in the position of believing contradictory claims, forcing a state of cognitive dissonance and potentially inhibiting the exploration that might uncover the truth. After all, if you believe God's responsible for the diversity of life, you might never discover that evolution serves not only as a naturalistic explanation, but it's sufficient to the task without requiring a God. It doesn't violate any laws of nature. The latter, withholding belief until it's justified, encourages discovery and puts us in a better position to ensure that our internal model of reality maps as accurately as possible to reality. It's worth noting that there's a difference between I do not believe X and I believe X is false, or I believe not X. This is a distinction that Eric and I have had difficulty discussing in the past. In a trial, the claim is that the defendant is guilty. If I say I do not believe that the defendant is guilty, that doesn't mean that I am convinced that the defendant is innocent. That's a separate proposition of which I'd need to be convinced. In the case of all gods, I find them not guilty of existing, in part because it's the default position, and in part because I've not been presented with sufficient evidence to accept that they exist. In the case of the many versions of the God of the Bible, I also find them not guilty of existing, and there are quite a few that I would probably also find innocent, because they are self-contradictory or because they are in direct conflict with what we understand and about reality. We need some right way of rationally evaluating the evidence for a claim, whether it's guilt or existence, but how do we go about this? How much evidence is enough? What criteria do we use? The scientific method is rigorous for very good reason. Basically, it's a truth filter, and the goal is to minimize the number of false propositions that make it through that filter. Skepticism makes use of critical thinking and a layman's version of a scientific method to establish a default position that we should question everything and accept only those explanations that are strongly supported. When we evaluate the God of the Bible, where do we begin? The concept isn't well defined. There are over 1,000 denominations that disagree on nearly every point of doctrine. They have different views of soteriology, the process by which one achieves or is granted salvation. They have different views of what we're being saved from or to. Is there a hell? What is heaven like? They have different views of the character and values of God. And this mess leaves us in a position of being left with the, quote, God of the Bible being loosely defined as some powerful being that may or may not be all-powerful, but is generally viewed as being the most powerful being possible, though we have no way of knowing how much power is possible or even what power even means in this context. This being may or may not exist outside of space-time, a concept which is completely incoherent. Because existence is necessarily temporal, so we don't even have the right language to discuss what it means or even if it's possible to exist outside space-time or even there's anything outside of space-time. This being may or may not act within the world, perhaps, or perhaps not, on behalf of the request of the faithful. Matthew 18:19 says, if two of you on earth agree about anything they ask for, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. Clearly, no two believers have ever agreed and asked for anything worthwhile, like an end to poverty or the fact, or even that God might reveal himself to me. This being may or may not act in accordance with his plan or only in accordance with his plan. The God of the Bible is defined differently by each of his adherents. While this puts us in the awkward position of not being able to pinpoint a definition to confirm, this does demonstrate rather clearly that there isn't sufficient evidence to rationally justify belief, but I think it goes further. The various denominations and interpretations demonstrate that Christianity doesn't have a coherent God concept to address. What does this tell us about their God? Either he's the worst communicator one could imagine, or he simply doesn't exist. There's no clear correction to doctrine. The New Testament, even when viewed as Bible 2.0, doesn't really clarify anything and doesn't have any more evidence behind it than the Old Testament. This God apparently created the entire universe, stuck us in it, gave us a brain that uses reason to discover all the truths about reality, and then he's either intentionally hiding or he doesn't exist. If the God of the Bible were real, then either he cares about the fact that so many people misunderstand him or he doesn't. If he cares, he hasn't bothered to correct this, and that creates a reducto ad absurdum that demonstrates that this God either doesn't exist or doesn't care. If he doesn't care that people misunderstand him, then this contradicts what people believe about him, which means that each of their self-constructed God models, wherein God cares that they understand him correctly, is false and self-contradictory, and the God that they believe in doesn't exist. These clear problems with doctrine and individual views of this poorly defined God are not only the reason that we have many hundreds of different denominations, it's the reason that Christian apologists tend to defend the various arguments that point to a deistic God instead of actually defending the God they believe in. Today's debate, though, is based on Eric defending the God of the Bible, so we'll let him give his definition, which he's done, and we'll examine it. Is it a defense of the God of the Bible, or is it yet another defense of deism? If he presents this clear model of his version of the God of the Bible, one of the immediate questions we have to ask is, why that model? What is it about Eric's version of the God of the Bible that's better or more clear than anyone else's? What kind of gods could exist? And we know as a fact that either a God exists or it doesn't. Those are the only two possibilities. And if it doesn't, then we're done. If it does exist, then either it manifests in reality in some detectable way, or it doesn't. And if it doesn't, once again, we're done. Because the God that doesn't exist is indistinguishable from the God that doesn't manifest in reality. And if it does, and this seems to be the God that most people believe in, manifest in reality, a God who answers prayers, performs miracles, intervenes and intercedes on behalf of the faithful, then what do we do? Well, that seems like a testable proposition. And we've tried testing it. People run around claiming to be little God detectors and getting having a personal relationship and getting messages, which seems strange to me because I can easily demonstrate, and so can they, every other personal relationship they have, which seems to make this particular relationship a bit of special pleading. When arguing on behalf of God, most of the common arguments boil down to some version of, well, what better explanation is there other than God did it, which is a version of the argument from ignorance fallacy that's been labeled by Dawkins and others as the argument from personal incredulity, which is actually just an expression of the fact that some people are so uncomfortable with not knowing that they'll accept whatever answer seems best. But God has no explanatory power. The God concept cannot explain a thing. It's a panacea that could serve as an answer for anything, and thus is an explanation for nothing. Not only does it suffer from this fatal flaw, but we explain things in terms of other things that we understand or can clearly demonstrate, neither of which applies to God. So we're just trying to answer a mystery by appealing to a bigger mystery. But it also bleeds to death and vanishes when we apply Occam's razor. If it's okay to propose an all-powerful, vastly powerful, supernatural, magical cause, then we should also be able to propose a less powerful, supernatural, magical cause that is sufficient to what we're trying to explain. Something godlike with respect to the thing we're trying to explain, for example, the origin of the universe. Powerful universe-creating pixies become more plausible than God because they don't have the added baggage of being able to do anything. They're a better explanation, though still no explanation at all. Unfortunately for theists, there's no way to test or falsify their claims. And the claims have no explanatory power, and we can propose less inflated versions of magical beings that are sufficient to the task, and worse. As we explore the universe in which we live, we discover that nothing about it requires any thinking agent to violate the laws of nature in order to accomplish anything. And the comparisons that we make within the universe, we cannot logically extend these to the universe itself. It's a unique scenario. It's like saying, hey, why are photons the only thing that can instantly accelerate to light speed? That doesn't make any sense. We have nothing with which to compare it. And when we're talking about universes, we have no other universes with which to compare our current one. So I don't know how one can presume that they have come up with the cause and that it necessarily needs to be a personal agent, which then becomes the Christian God. If we live in a world with a God and that God can do anything, we can trust nothing. Science goes right out the window. Maybe that heart medication really works, or maybe God just made it look like it works, or maybe God's going to change the way it works. And there's people who would argue that without God, we can have no reason. But I'd argue that it seems likely that there can be no reliable reasoning within reality about the facts of reality if that reality includes a God that can change those facts. much like the sun orbiting the Earth, we're clearly in a position where we know enough to know that some claims simply aren't rationally justified, and the God of the Bible is one of them.
Perfect timing. Coming up next, each will get a chance to offer a rebuttal. More Dogma Debate coming up. Gain comfort in finally having control over your life. Gain comfort in knowing just the fact that you were born is an amazing thing.
Dogma Debate helped me during the beginning stage of my journey of unbelief.
The evolution segment is definitely my favorite segment.
And when I couldn't talk to my friends and family about my beliefs, it was very refreshing listening to Dogma Debate.
Come on, guys. Do I really need to sit and talk to you about hominids for the next 4 hours? Because I don't want to do it.
When I would look at the universe and then I would try to squeeze God into it, things didn't make sense anymore.
No, it's just Trent being crazy with machinery in his home.
The hosts have really good chemistry with each other.
As the podcast has grown, I have as well, and I'd like to think that Dogma Debate did have something to do with that.
Rachel and Jerry DeWitt are very friendly, and Trent makes it unique with his drops.
When I realized that the fourth was strong with Dogma Debate, I found that I had access to the best community of atheists and secular humanists available.
Rachel to the rescue!
I've learned a lot. It's very entertaining and informative.
Very entertaining from a secular perspective.
Dogma Debate definitely highlighted my week.
Dogma Debate gave me the courage to reach out and become an activist in the movement myself.
My name is Trace Madison, and I'm the fourth listener.
I am Jonathan Good, and I am the fourth listener.
I am Jesse, and I am the fourth listener.
I am Anthony Harden, and I am the fourth listener.
If you've been missing Dogma Debate, man, it sucks to be you.
Welcome back to Dogma Debate, where we're doing a very special edition, a live formal debate with Matt Dillahunty versus Eric Lounsbery. Both gentlemen have had a very good opening statement, and now it's time to begin the rebuttal round, where first Eric will have a rebuttal for what Matt just said. He'll have 15 minutes to respond, and then Matt will have a 15-minute rebuttal to Eric's opening statement, as well as what he has to say now. So, Eric, you have the floor. You have 15 minutes. Go ahead.
Okay, David, if you could give me just one quick second, because I wanted to point out in your email regarding this section of the debate that this 15 minutes, that there were no strict rules and we were to respond or introduce evidence as needed. And I want to point out that since I have the positive claim in this debate, it's essential that I give evidence that for my claim. And Matt has said many times that he really doesn't have any evidence that he has to present to try to prove his case. He just has to rebut my case.
Well, I need
to give evidence to support the existence of the Christian God.
The reason I put that in there is because a lot of times in rebuttal rounds, people will say, oh yeah, I just thought of this, by the way, and then some people will try to throw a flag at that and say, wait, you can't offer any new evidence at this point. So I put that stipulation in there that if either of you think of something during this round, you are in fact allowed to say it. That's what I meant by you're allowed to introduce evidence as needed, because I don't want really strict restrictions on this. That was the point of that.
Okay, so let me ask you this then. I will ask your permission and Matt's permission, since I have to defend that the God that exists is the God of the Bible. Obviously in 10 minutes, simply taking the time to demonstrate God exists is quite a task to do, but to show that that's the God of the Bible, I'm wondering if Matt would be willing to give me some of this time, and I will forego some other time to present, some of the other time in the debate.
Well, this 15 minutes, Eric, is designed for you to offer your rebuttal. During your rebuttal of Matt's opening statement, you are allowed to introduce other evidence. That's what this segment is for. So you have 15 minutes, not 10, to offer a rebuttal to Matt's open. Are you ready to begin?
Absolutely.
Okay, go ahead. Your timer starts now.
Okay, Matt, you stated that when we go ahead and appeal to God as a answer for the creation of the universe, that what we're doing is we're appealing to a, we're trying to solve a mystery by appealing to a bigger mystery. Just want to point out that the thing is, evidence for a claim that when you give evidence to go ahead and solve a mystery by appealing to a bigger mystery, that does not mean that your argument is fallacious, because just imagine this. The SETI program listens to outer space to hear something if it indicates that life is out there. And when the pings or whatever is heard are listened to, and it is determined that it shows that intelligent life exists, would this be appealing to a bigger mystery? Because now the mystery that is in front of you is far greater than simply determining that it was a message that indicates intelligent life. Next, suppose you find a body lying dead on the sidewalk. You can't tell if they died of natural causes or if they were murdered. If the mystery is solved by forensics, then indeed the person was murdered. Now a bigger mystery opens up. You have to try to determine who murdered the person. So just because we appeal to a bigger mystery, this same kind of thing could be said of the Big Bang. You know, when we go ahead and come to the conclusion that a Big Bang occurred, that also appeals to a bigger mystery. Next, you pointed out that in Matthew chapter 18, verse 19, that it says that if two of you will agree on earth as touching anything, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. What's interesting about that, Matt, is you actually applied that passage out of context. The passage has nothing to do with two people standing and praying like, oh, we're going to go ahead and request that God do a miracle. That passage pertains to judgment regarding a person in sin. If you go ahead and read that entire chapter, the whole chapter of 18 from beginning to end pertains to that subject, so you simply misapplied the scripture. Next, you stated that the evidence for the existence of God is not sufficient. Well, we're going to have opportunity when we do the cross-examination to go ahead and determine that, because again, as I pointed out, not only do we have the scientific evidence, but we also have God doing exactly what most atheists say he has never done. And that is, why doesn't he reveal himself to me? But the vast majority of atheists, as I said, you and Professor Krauss have both testified that you believe that men are hardwired to believe in God. So it's like saying, okay, God, go ahead and give me some kind of evidence that you exist. And then when he gives you an internal testimony, when he speaks to your heart and says, you know what, I'm the God that exists, you say, oh, that's not God. That's just the result of evolution. Next, you say that people have different opinions about theology. I don't see what that has to do with the argument, because stop and think about it. There are plenty of people who are part of my life who might have an opinion about how I might respond or how I might act if they were asked certain questions. But even though those people may have differing opinions as to how I'm going to respond, what I'm going to do, none of that changes the fact that I exist, just because some people have one view of me and other people have a differing view. You talk about the fact that so many other gods have existed and that science has eliminated all of these other gods. And again, one of the things that I've tried to point out is that the difference with the Christian God is that he does give evidence for himself. As a matter of fact, in Romans chapter 1, it clearly says that God has not only revealed himself to men, but it says that they suppress the truth, and that which may be known of God is manifest in them. So again, we find the scripture testifying to the very thing that you and others have said, and that is that God does testify of his presence. And it says that God has shown it unto them. And he says, from the creation of the world, His invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and godhood. So the scripture itself gives us a method by which we can know for certain that God exists. And every single thing inside of us tells us when we look out and we see the creation, that just by using the principle of uniformity and the law of cause and effect, we find ourselves coming to the conclusion that the attributes that science reveals about God, these are the very attributes that the Bible stated regarding him long before science ever came to the conclusion. You say that whenever, when men took a look at the sun and they had false views about the rotation of the earth and other astronomical data, that because they went ahead and they thought that the certain claim was true and they later found out that the claim was false, you introduced this as some kind of evidence that, you know what, yeah, we go ahead and we think this is evidence for God, and then we find out that it's not. But I just want to point out something. So many times when an atheist argues that that a Christian is using the God of the gaps as an argument, and we're saying, you know what, we have no idea why the rotation of the planets occur like it does, because since we don't have any idea, we're simply going to say God did it. But the difference is, in presenting the claims that I presented, I did not say we have no known cause for what is happening. As a matter of fact, my arguments are based upon the soundest laws of science, the law of cause and effect, and it's based upon evidence. So this is a completely different scenario. When a person is applying the God of the gaps, that argument is when a person has no other known cause for what happened. It's like they see lightning, they don't understand the natural cause, and they say, God did it. That is not what I've done in this debate. Next. You say, how is it possible for something to exist outside of this universe? We don't even know if that's a possibility. Well, again, that's one of the reasons why I gave the evidence from Lawrence Krauss and showed that he has been forced by the evidence to come to the conclusion that there is an eternal transcendent cause. And even if he says that this is not something certain, He has definitely declared that this is what the evidence demonstrates, that there is an eternal transcendent cause. And my contention is that neither Lawrence nor you nor any other person can show how this eternal cause is capable of doing the things that it is, that it is not capable of creating the things that are created unless that cause has intelligence. So the fact that you say that we can't appeal to the idea of something being outside the universe, again, I would say science once again seems to be kept catching up with theology. And as it continues, I think that it'll get closer and closer to the fact that God exists. You say that the God hypothesis has no explanatory power. It certainly does, Matt. It has amazing explanatory power. It explains why, when you go ahead and if you were to commit a murder, why you would feel guilty. It explains why, no matter how hard you try, you cannot deny the fact that you have free will. It explains why there is an inward testimony inside of you that you are of far greater value than a dog or a mouse or a cockroach. It explains the fact of the resurrection. It explains how men like the Apostle Paul who was vehemently opposed to Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, the Apostle Paul made you and every other atheist that I've ever known look like a sissy atheist, because this is a man who not only was he vehemently opposed to Christianity, but he went out persecuting Christians, wanting to put them to death. But yet this man experienced a appearance of Christ that to such a degree that not only did he have a complete dramatic change in his opinion, but he would spend the rest of his life preaching this gospel. So how can somebody go ahead and explain that? I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to contend, Matt, that you cannot explain the transformation in the life of the Apostle Paul in light of what the Scripture says happened, and not only that, but in light of what the historical evidence was. Not only that, but the evidence also gives significant explanatory power as to when you go ahead and you look at the gospel, it does give explanatory power by saying that there is a God, because one, it finally provides a means for Jesus to be raised from the dead. Because all of these other religions, whenever anybody claims that there is a God, the question is, if they claim that there was a dying and rising God, one of the first questions that somebody should ask is, how did this person die, and how did they, or why did they die, and how were they raised from the dead? Because if there's no tool to raise the person from the dead, then obviously the person is not going to rise. So once the fact of God is introduced, then the concept of a resurrection is absolutely easier to explain. As a matter of fact, a person that you're very familiar with, Jeffrey Lauder, says this. He says the first question that somebody should ask upon hearing a claim that Jesus rose from the dead is, how should they do it? He says, suppose that someone presumably with a reliable testimony, suppose that they had just claimed that they flew over a lake by flapping their arms. Surely no rational person would take such a claim seriously. Lauder goes on to say, but what if God does exist? He's asking about the explanatory power of it. And he says, what is the background probability of a miraculous event like the resurrection if God exists? I think that the theist can plausibly argue that the background probability is much improved, if not high, under such conditions, given that God exists. He says there are good reasons to believe that God will intervene. So this explains, as a matter of fact, he says the reasons that you should believe that he would intervene is because if there is a God who's the creator of the universe and the laws that govern it, then it seems reasonable to believe that he would be able to temporarily suspend the laws of nature. If God could create the universe ex nihilo, then surely a resurrection or a levitation would pale into comparison. Secondly, as philosopher Richard Swinburne argues, there's good reason to believe that if God exists, he would reveal himself through a divine miracle at some point in human history. And he says, finally, for these two reasons alone, I think theists can plausibly argue that if the God of the Bible exists, then there's prior probability, then the prior probability of the resurrection is high. And I want to remind you, this is Jeff Lauder, and for those of you who don't know Jeff Lauder, he is the founder of the largest atheist presence on the web, which is Internet Infidels. And once again, if God exists, then this gives great explanatory power to the things that we see in the Scriptures, because one, it was this God who had the means to raise Jesus from the dead. It was this God who said he would raise him from the dead. He had the motive to raise him from the dead, because you know, Matt, from reading the Old Testament, that it would explain the very purposes that the Old Testament was written down. Everything in the Old Testament testified that the time would come when there would be a new covenant, that this the person who would bring in this new covenant would be a light to the Gentiles, which is absolutely fulfilled in the life of Jesus, and I don't think that you could mention anybody else who is even a possibility for this happening. Not only that, but it also gives explanatory power to the confession that Jesus himself said he would die and rise from the dead. And not only that, but it would explain why the supporting evidence that we get from the contemporaries of Jesus, why they don't deny these things. And what I mean by that is this. Stop and think about it, Matt. You yourself said that if you want to know what's wrong with Christianity, ask a Jew. Why? Well, the reason you said that is because we know there is a certainty that whenever you ask an opponent that disagrees with you, if they go ahead and give evidence to facts that support you and actually would make them that's going to go against them giving you that kind of evidence is considered to be some of the strongest evidence that there is, because why would they go ahead and do it? Well, stop and think about it. The Jewish people have always testified to the historicity of Jesus. They've testified to the fact that he died on a cross, that he was buried, and they testified that the Sunday following the crucifixion, the tomb was empty and the body was gone.
You have 30 seconds, Eric.
all of these things taken together, the explanatory power that God gives is that everything he promised, everything that testified, everything that Jesus testified about regarding why he came and what he would do, we find its fulfillment in the life, death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Eric. Mad Dillahunty, your 15-minute rebuttal.
Sure, and lots of notes scattered all over the place. Beginning with Eric's opening statement, he talked about the idea that existence doesn't come from non-existence. I don't know how you actually determine that, because we don't have a non-existence to examine. This seems to be an inference or a bit of induction, inductive reasoning based on things within the universe. And as I pointed out in the opening statement, the fact that something works this way within the universe doesn't mean that you can necessarily apply it to the universe itself. There's nothing similar that we can examine. We have no second universe, so we could see what a intentionally created, designed universe looks like compared to something else. I want to correct right off the bat where he says that I've claimed that I think people are programmed to believe in God. I'd be interested to see exactly where that came from, because whenever I talk about this and the idea of the God module, etc., it's my general position is that this is a byproduct, that it's not like there's a module in the brain that we're programmed to believe in God. We are thinking beings, and we make mistakes. And that this is a better explanation of how we came to believe in all of the other gods and the one that Eric believes in as well. When Krauss, the original audio that Eric played, spoke about the universe having a beginning, if you listen very carefully, what Krauss said was the visible universe. And there's a distinction between the visible universe, the thing that we tend to describe as the universe, and then the cosmos, which is everything. And Krauss's position seemed to be based on the multiverse. Hey, our visible universe had some beginning. I'm fine with that. I don't object to that. Okay, why is Krauss convinced, reluctantly, even though he doesn't like the multiverse, that this is the best current explanation? And it's because that the science has led him to the conclusion that this is the best current explanation. Krauss is following the evidence towards a conclusion he doesn't particularly like, and Eric is not following the evidence. Instead, he's trying to lead it towards the conclusion that he likes, talking about, you know, a principle of uniformity, that similar effects have similar causes. This is not an absolute, and there are no similar effects to the origin of a universe. You just can't. And he used this primarily as talking about the sort of functionally specified intelligence in a cell. And quoted me about how we determine what the most rational cause is, and that there's only one known cause for producing that sort of specified intelligence or specified information, and that's intelligence. And the reply is pretty simply that there is no known intelligence outside the universe, and we have a natural explanation both for the universe, and we have a natural explanation for how this appearance of specified specified information actually arises. No magic required, no tampering from an external source required. There were some microphone issues, so I missed part of what he said when he went on to explain why this required intelligence is clearly the God of the Bible. And this is where I'm probably going to spend a bit of time, because that's the subject of the debate. You know, we're trying to determine whether or not it's rational to believe in the God of the Bible. And the thing that he began with in the opening statement is that atheists are big fat liars, that he's right, and that we are suppressing the inner testimony that tells us that God exists. We are suppressing views about free will. We are suppressing the idea that we are subject to the morality of the God he believes in. We are suppressing guilt and suppressing the idea that we, you know, we have to have some source saying that we're more valuable than a cockroach. It's curious, because I don't know how to respond to liar, liar, pants on fire as an argument for the existence of God. Well, you guys are just lying. No, if I tell you that I don't feel guilty for, let's say, masturbating, it's true, I don't. If I tell you that I do feel guilty, as you pointed out later on, for murdering someone, I don't know because I've never murdered anyone, but I presume that I would feel guilty, and it's not because a God exists. It's because I have an understanding of morality, which is not in any way, there's no God required for developing this. All you need are very simple premises that life is generally preferable to death, and a sense of empathy, and evaluating the kind of world you want to live in. Is it the kind of world where you could be killed at any moment, or is it the kind of world where we tend to discourage people from killing and stealing, etc.? But we're not doing a whole debate about morality, which we could do. But if I tell you that I'm not suppressing guilt, I find the Bible to be basically advocating an immoral God, a God who is sanctioning slavery, for example, and subjugation of women and all these other things. I generally view myself as morally superior to the character of God in the Bible, just as I am morally superior to Lord Voldemort. I don't have to offer up much more for this, and it wouldn't matter, because as I explain that I'm not guilty, Eric's reply is, oh, no, you're lying. You atheists are suppressing this. I don't know where the evidence is that we're suppressing this. I know what he pointed to. I know he pointed to Romans 1. Let's point back to the Bible to say that the invisible attributes is clearly seen from the beginning of time and blah, blah, blah. So now the Bible is calling us liars. Great, cool. I'm happy that you're a fan of the Bible saying that we're all denying it. That's what we call a self-reinforcing delusion. Hey, these people say that they don't believe. Ah, I'm the authority, and I'm telling you that they're lying. Oh, great, I accept you as the authority, so I'm going to say that they're liars too. So when we talk about the appeal to God, the mystery, trying to solve a mystery with a mystery, and whether or not God has any explanatory power, and he's convinced that God has explanatory power, the fact that something is consistent with a proposed answer doesn't mean that it has been explained in any way. And everything is consistent with something that can do anything. And so, of course, hey, if you begin, I mean, he quoted Jeffrey D. Lauder and a bunch of others, yes, I agree. If you begin with the proposition that a God exists and can do everything and created the universe, then a resurrection is trivial and possible. But you don't get to begin with the idea that a God exists, especially if the subject of the debate is it reasonable to believe that this God exists? You have to actually demonstrate it. You don't get to say that if this God exists, then we would expect this, because there, you know, if this God exists, we would expect a resurrection. Great, cool. That's neato, but it doesn't prove that a God exists. It just proves that your proposed explanation is consistent with what you think to be the facts and not. Eric played fast and loose several times with some quotes, which I'll get to, where it's the fact of the resurrection. I'm not aware that there is a fact of the resurrection. I know there's a claim of a resurrection. If I was aware that there was a fact of a resurrection, I'd be in an entirely different position. So this question about why doesn't God reveal himself, once again, he goes to this, well, he does. You guys are just denying the internal testimony. Well, that's fine. I did a debate in Kamloops, British Columbia, a few years ago at Imagine No Religion 2, a conference that I loved, and the ministers there flatly accused me of simply doing what Eric says I'm doing, which is suppressing this. Screw you guys. I mean, I mean that in the nicest way. If you're going to say that we're being sissy atheists, etc., you don't get to jump into my head and tell me that I'm lying about something. Much like the God claim, you actually need to demonstrate that this is the case. Because I was somebody who was a sincere believer, was not looking to disbelieve, was not looking for a way out, reached out to God repeatedly, and got nothing in response. This idea that God was revealing himself the whole time and that I'm just I didn't want this, or I'm too sinful. These are all post hoc rationalizations so that you don't have to address the fact that what we appear to see is you think God has revealed himself to everybody and everybody believes it, and there are people who claim that they don't believe. And so your response is that they are deceived, that they have deceived themselves, rather than looking at the possibility that in fact maybe the world and your God, if he exists, doesn't quite work the way you think that he does. Eric also mentioned that people have different opinions about how he might respond, but this doesn't change the fact that he exists. I absolutely agree. We should always try and find some point of agreement. But if we can't find Eric, and nobody seems to be able to allow us to have a conversation with Eric to find out what Eric wants, and when we investigate, we don't find any of the things we would normally expect to find for someone who was real and who existed, then what these people think about you is really irrelevant. And until such time as you step forward and say what you think, your existence and your non-existence are logically identical from the standpoint of the information that we have. He said that every single thing inside of us sees creation as clearly of God. Well, I guess if he can just say I'm lying, then my response is, no, that's not true. Not only am I in the position where every single thing inside of me doesn't see creation, doesn't even see creation, it sees existence, doesn't see it as clearly of God. It makes for a rather poor debate when one person can just say, this is the way it is, and if you disagree, you're lying. And then I'm stuck saying, well, I disagree. I don't feel that. I don't see that. When I look around at creation, one example that I've used is about a beaver dam. If you stumble across a bunch of sticks in mud that looks very much like a beaver dam, how do you go about determining whether it's a beaver dam or whether it was just a flood and this came together? And the hallmarks of these things, much like the I love you example, are that we look at the features of this and we compare it to what we already know about reality. If we know nothing, then we can say nothing. But if every example of this that is consistent prior to this is from an intelligent source, and no examples of this occurring in this fashion are from non-intelligent sources, then we can reasonably conclude that this is most probably from an intelligent source. Now, we talked a little bit about the sun and the earth and the fact that they thought, you know, the claim was true, and I introduced this as of evidence that the God belief may be wrong. And yes, that's true. Just like we didn't have an explanation for thunder and lightning, and that was Zeus, and Ra pulled the sun across the sky. The idea that you can just chuck all that out and say, yes, but my God is real, and the evidence supports that, is really strange, because he rejected this idea that, you know, God did it as a claim. The God of the gaps idea is not what he's engaged in, and his position is actually based on evidence, and he's wrong. Because science doesn't address the supernatural and cannot confirm supernatural causation. So there has to be a disconnect when you try to claim that the laws of the universe attest to something supernatural, because you can't get there in science at all. Science recognizes this limitation. It doesn't claim that the supernatural doesn't exist. It just says that we can never confirm supernatural causation. I mean, for example, you know, we touched briefly on the idea of prophecy. He seems to conclude that the most reasonable explanation for the apparent fulfillment of prophecy is that it was real prophecy and came from God. I don't know how you determine that that's the most likely explanation when you have no priors to actually investigate and calculate with, but also in a world where we know that people lie, that people deceive, that there are coincidences and other things, I don't know how you would conclude that the most reasonable explanation is that they got this right, assuming they even did get it right, because God told them ahead of time. Now, he and Krauss, he said that neither Lawrence Krauss nor I, nor any other person, can show how this eternal cause, perhaps the multiverse, can create a universe without intelligence. Well, that's true. I'm not a physicist. I can't demonstrate how it can do it. All I can say is that this is one of the competing models of the origins of the universe, and it doesn't include any intelligence and doesn't seem to require any intelligence. But when you say God is the most reasonable explanation and you guys are denying this, and instead you're latching on to maybe a multiverse thing, when you can't show how this eternal cause can create without intelligence, that is an argument from ignorance fallacy. Straight up, no two ways about it. If your position is that your God explanation is more reasonable because it has an intelligence and we can't show how something happened without intelligence, and therefore you are justified, argument from ignorance. Eric thinks that science will get closer and closer to God exists, which demonstrates that he doesn't really get science. Because if God is supernatural and science can never confirm supernatural causation, then I fail to see how science can get closer and closer to God exists. And the evidence that we have about where science is leading us is further and further away from these supernatural explanations because they are no longer necessary. Because we have learned more about the universe. And this is why in my opening statement, I had said that I'm not convinced that God was ever a rational conclusion. But it certainly isn't now that we know so much more. Why did Paul change his mind? He says, I can't explain that. How can you explain how Cat Stevens gave up a successful music career to become a reclusive Muslim without, you know, if Islam is not true? Sorts of armchair arguments really get us no closer to the truth. And if you're just going to say that I'm lying, then we're kind of stuck for the rest of the time.
We are officially 30 minutes away from taking your live questions. Several questions have already come in through Twitter, but they all seem to be for Eric. So if you folks have questions for Matt, be sure to live tweet those at David C. Smalley, and we'll be taking calls in about 30 minutes at 214-377-1166. 214-377-1166. Don't call yet. Wait until I tell you to call. Coming up next, the cross exams. The cross-examination, Matt will go first after the break, cross-examining Eric, and then Eric will get to cross-exam Matt. And the way this is going to work is each person's going to own their own time, a question, interrupt, do what they need to do, but we'll talk about all of those rules as soon as we come back. There is more Dogma Debate coming up.
Now it's time for an AtheistAudiobooks.com sneak preview.
The happy atheist disproving Christianity after faith in our Constitution baptized atheists of God virus.
Here's an excerpt from The Happy Atheist by P.Z. Myers, read by Aaron Raw.
You may not believe me, but I swear it's true. I'm not of this earth. I fled here years ago because my home planet was driving me crazy. Let me explain. My home world is very much like this one. It's populated by billions of bipedal primates who are just like people here, sometimes foolish, sometimes wise, sometimes hateful, sometimes generous. They're grouped into cities and nations, and sometimes they have wars, and sometimes they cooperate. You really would have a hard time telling our two planets apart, except for one thing. The hats. My people are obsessed with hats. Almost everyone wears them, and a lot of their identity is wrapped up in their particular style. Some people always wear cowboy hats, for instance, and others wear bowlers, and each think the other is exceedingly funny looking and would never consider switching. They have elaborate ceremonies for their children in which they confer the hats, and children often go to special schools once a week where they learn about the history and significance of their hats. From birth to death, everyone has the importance of hats drilled into them. The particular type of hat was critical. Individuals only rarely changed hat styles, and when they did, it was considered grounds for sorrow by those who wore the abandoned style and cause for rejoicing by those wearing the newly adopted style. Sometimes people would invent new kinds of hats, which were typically regarded as bizarre when one person was wearing it, but once a sufficient number switched to the new style, they were respected automatically. It meant that streets of our more cosmopolitan cities were filled with strange and comical hats bobbing along, but no one laughed. Laughing at a hat was considered a heinous crime. It sounds very silly, I know. A minority on my planet also find it pointless, myself among them, and didn't bother wearing a hat at all. This is tolerated in the more civilized nations, although there are places where wearing no hat or a strange hat can get you killed.
The Happy Atheist by P.Z. Myers is now available on AtheistAudiobooks.com.
This is Andrea Garrichin, the fourth listener from Sydney, Australia, and you're listening to The Dogma Debate with David Smalley.
I'm friends with the monster that's under my bed. Get along with the voices and
crazy. Yeah, you think I'm crazy.
Welcome back to Dogma Debate. We're reminding everybody, if you're a listener of the show, you want that premium content, behind-the-scenes video, audio, the private Facebook, all that stuff. Anyone who signs up as a premium member at login.dogmadebate.com until Friday, April 18th, automatically gets a free audiobook from atheistaudiobooks.com. We will find you when you sign up. We'll be contacting you to get that free audiobook. This next section of the debate is often the most exciting. It's really a lot of fun for the listeners, a lot of fun for the debaters, not always so much fun for the moderator. So, you guys get to cross-examine one another. You get to use your own time. You could talk the entire time if you wanted, or ask questions of the other person. Matt is going to go first. We know I've already heard the term sissy atheist, and I've already heard the term screw you guys. So let's make sure we keep it civil. Hopefully you guys won't step on each other too much. Try not to interrupt each other, but also try to keep your answers to each other's responses quite short so that I won't have to intervene, because if you're both talking, no one's listening. So Matt, you're up first. You have 15 minutes to cross-examine Eric. You have the floor.
Sure. And I'll point out that screw you guys was a response to being called a liar. But, you know, so there's a bit more there. But so I've got a bunch of questions, and so we'll just get to it. So the first one's one I asked the other day of someone else, and I'm curious mostly to hear Eric's answers. You have two different people who claim that they have seen an angel and received a message from an angel. And given that these are competing, for whatever reason, we conclude that one of them actually saw an angel and got a message, and the other one didn't. How can we tell the difference in order to reach this conclusion about who actually got the message?
So, I want to make sure I'm understanding the question correctly, Matt. Are you saying, how can we tell that we're interpreting this message clearly, or are we trying to determine whether or not the person actually got the message?
Yeah, the second. Let me kind of rephrase it. One person clearly didn't get it, speak to an angel. Their vision of an angel wasn't real. They have some psychosis and probably need some medication. And the other one got a real message from an angel. How can we tell the difference between the two of them?
Well, the thing is like in any situation, Matt, I think you would agree that unless there is some kind of objective evidence, we're not going to be able to come to that conclusion. I mean, that's one of the reasons why you have so many false religions starting, is because the issue is, you know, did this person actually have a vision from God, and are you going to believe it? And I think that in any position that we're going to take, if we're going to go ahead and we're going to accept the idea that a miracle occurred or that divine intervention occurred, that we had ought to only do that when there is very strong objective evidence to it.
Okay, and so if somebody just said that my aunt told me she had a vision of an angel and here's what it said, we shouldn't believe her.
Right. Absolutely not. Why would you believe anything without evidence? That's, in my opinion, that's ridiculous. If you're the kind of person who's going to go ahead and accept a position apart from evidence, you're a foolish person and you're headed for trouble.
I agree. So why should we believe Paul?
Well, let's put it this way, Matt. If we go ahead and we look at the life of Paul, there's a couple things we notice about his character. I think that you will agree, if we're going to accept even the basic testimony of his character, we find Paul to be a very competent person, in the sense that he was certainly able to go ahead and reasonably argue against the Pharisees and defend the fact that Jesus was the fulfillment of the Old Testament, and his claims to this day still stand. So we see Paul as a reasonable man, and as a matter of fact, he was even described as a person who excelled exceedingly above all of his peers. And so go ahead and take what the vast majority of critics accept, and that is that Paul had this transformation on the road to Damascus. The vast majority of them argue that Paul truly did have this experience. And I think that you'll agree that is what the vast majority of the critics argue. The question is, what was the nature of the experience? Was it that Paul had a hallucination or a vision? Well, when you go ahead and you take a look at what the scripture says, clearly the conversion of the Apostle Paul on the road to Damascus was Jesus physically appearing to him after the resurrection. Scarcely any scholar, liberal or critical, denies that this event occurred, though they may argue if it was a physical appearance. Well, clearly it was a physical appearance, Matt. After all, the appearance of Jesus to Paul was so bright that he actually physically lost his sight.
How do you know?
Hey, Eric.
Eric,
this is technically Matt's time, so keep your answers a little shorter. I think Matt wants to respond.
Yeah, okay. There's a if you trail on for 5 minutes about this, my question is, you know, this is a self-reported event, and you're seem to be kind of contradicting yourself, because in this case you're willing to believe it because Paul's life was changed. But the fact that Paul's life was changed only shows that he believed it if in fact this happened. I mean, first of all, I don't see any reason to think that this actually, you know, happened. But that Paul believed it is all that's necessary to invoke this change, that it doesn't necessarily have to be true to invoke a change.
So, Matt, let me ask you this, I will just say, rationally speaking, when the critics go ahead and they accept that Paul had this transformation, considering that visions and hallucinations of a bright light will no more make a person go blind than hallucinating your neck in a guillotine with a blade dropping causes your head to fall off, Paul physically went blind.
How do you know?
We're going to accept his conversion, but we're going to reject everything that he told us about it. It clearly shows confirmation bias in the words of David Smalley.
How do you know that Paul actually went blind?
Well, the thing is we know, because let's put it this way, if the critical scholars are going to accept everything else about that experience, Matt, are we going to accept everything but reject that? When clearly this man had to have some experience that so transformed his life that as he was going around putting Christians to death, now he's going to spend every waking moment of the rest of his life propagating the gospel? I mean, you want to talk about something with explanatory power, Matt. I don't know how you could have any more explanatory power than that.
There's nothing explanatory about it. I mean, but I'm still asking how you know any of this is actually true and real. But the fact that somebody changed their mind and had a transforming experience doesn't mean that you get to assert that the cause of this is that there actually is a God who changed them, any more than, you know, any other religion would claim that somebody changed their life because their God is real.
Matt, in light of all of the other evidence, that the scientific evidence that I gave that supports the
There's
existence...
no scientific evidence for what happened to Paul.
I'm going to tell you, because if God does exist, according to the words that came out of your own mouth just a few minutes ago, if God exists, the resurrection is nothing. So certainly if God exists, according to what Jeff Lauder from Internet Infidel says, we would expect him to reveal himself to mankind because he would want to get his message out. Why did he choose Paul, Matt? Because when this conversion took place, how many people do you know that when they are converted, how many, you name me one person on planet Earth that worked harder after their conversion than the Apostle Paul. That's the reason why God chose him, because God went ahead and said, you know what, here's a man that is, here he is, he's the strongest man in opposition to me. Of all of the people he could possibly convert, that he could reveal himself to, of all of the people on planet Earth, Matt, who better than the Apostle Paul? I mean, that would be like modern day that he reveals himself to you and Lawrence Krauss.
And please explain to me why everybody else on the planet, including me and Lawrence Krauss, don't deserve the same sort of revelation that Paul had.
The reason why is because when God revealed himself to Paul, he knew that Paul, he had a plan that he wanted accomplished, and he picked the man who he knew would go ahead and accomplish that plan. And I do believe that you're wrong about that, Matt, because I do believe that God has sufficiently revealed himself to you. As a matter of fact, I think that when we go ahead and we discuss the evidence, that you're going to find that you're ill-prepared to be able to respond against the proofs that God has given.
Good, that's great, but this is still my time, and so basically you're saying that you think God already has, but I haven't had a Damascus Road experience, but we'll move on to something else. Did God create the entire universe?
Of course.
Did he have a choice about what universe he created?
Of course.
Did he create it knowing everything that would happen?
Of course.
So how then can you talk about free will if God could have created a universe in which I didn't agree to this debate and I didn't end up as an atheist, but instead he chose this particular universe and we cannot violate that because if we violate that, then God was wrong about what would happen. This is the problem where you talked about free will, where the Christian idea of creation, of a God who knows the future, chose this particular future, violates the idea that we have free will at all.
Okay. This is how I respond to that, Matt. I think that actually, under the circumstances, there are a number of possibilities where God doing this does not seem to violate free will at all. Let me give you an example. Let's just suppose you're a sports fan and you happen to sit down with a buddy and you're going to watch a game and you guys bet $1,000 on who the winner is and you pick the New England Patriots and you sit there and you tell him when you're watching the game, you say, here's what's going to happen, here's what's going to happen next, this guy's going to score a touchdown, you give him all of the details. Okay, well, as you're sitting there doing this, the guy's like, man, what are you? You know, you've got to be some kind of divinity. You're giving me exactly what's going to happen. Well, the thing is, what he doesn't know is that the game was actually played earlier in the day. You videotaped it. You watched the game. So because God is outside of time, he is able to go ahead and traverse time and know what is going to take place. And so in going ahead and saying, here's what's going to happen, it is not a violation of free will any more than you looking at the videotape, watching these guys carry out these certain actions. They do them all according to their own free will, but because you're quote-unquote sort of outside of time and you've already seen what's going to happen, you already know exactly what's going to take place, so there's nothing that catches you by surprise, but none of that negates the fact that the people playing have a free will. But even actually, if that scenario doesn't fit, Matt, even if we don't see that free will,
Eric,
it does not do
Eric,
anything to the evidence of God's existence.
Eric, okay, come on, let's let Matt respond.
Actually, there is a problem with that, and that is that if you put me in the position of God, I'm going to look through a bunch of tapes, and I'm going to pick the tape that has the conclusion that I want to reach. It isn't about whether or not those individuals in there actually took those actions. It's that this was the specific game that I picked, knowing this was going to be the conclusion. And so if I rewatch the tape, nothing about it can ever change. But anyway,
I violate the fact that the players had free will, Matt.
It does, because we're living in the replay.
Okay, and so time is relative. So how does that violate the fact that they had free will?
The players don't live in the replay. If we are the replay, God has specifically chosen the replay with these specific outcomes, as opposed to choosing the game where the Patriots lost. But in any case, what would change your mind?
What would change my mind?
Yeah, about God.
Nothing.
Okay.
That would be like, what would change my mind that I know that I exist? I know that God exists because I know him.
That's fine.
And yeah.
That's fine. It answered the question. So basically, there must be a cause for the visible universe. You've said so. Cross agrees. I'm not going to deny that. And you think that this must be a thinking agent, and that this leads to, through your original opening statement, that the God of the Bible is the one that is most consistent with the properties you would expect for this thinking agent, correct?
Exactly.
So now, obviously, I disagree with the initial conclusion about a thinking agent, but let's say that I grant that for a moment. Why is it, first of all, that thinking agent couldn't be universe-creating pixies, and why is it also not the case that it couldn't be some other unknown God, which is in fact more consistent with what we would expect, and yet we're unaware of?
Well, it's a nice question, and I think that the evidence is, the reason why is this, because when you go ahead and you see the attributes that these premises reveal about the God, the question is, has any deity stepped forward saying, these are the attributes that I have? Well, the thing is that the God of the Bible certainly did that. And
that's correlation, not causation.
Well, but then here's the other thing, Matt. He has demonstrated himself to be that God.
How?
So, again, by resurrecting Jesus Christ from the dead, and I also...
I don't know that happened. That's no demonstration to me.
Proof for the God of the Bible.
I don't know that happened, so that's not a demonstration to me. there's a claim that God resurrected Jesus, but we don't know that that's true. And so I have no way of saying, ah, yes, Jesus was resurrected, therefore God.
Okay, let's put it this way, Matt. If we're in the courtroom and we're going to try to find God guilty of raising Jesus Christ from the dead, anytime you're in a courtroom, this is what you're looking for. If you're trying to prove your case, you want to show that there was means. We've done that. You want to show that there was motive. The entirety of the Old Testament hinged upon the death, burial, and resurrection of the Messiah. There was confession. There was eyewitnesses. There was opposing. There was opponents' testimony that supported the idea of the historical life, death, burial, and empty tomb of Jesus Christ.
No, there aren't
too many attorneys that won't want to take a case that has that kind of evidence in supporting it.
Matt, you have 60 seconds to wrap up the cross-examination of Eric.
Sure. So why is it that your God can't be clear and give clear evidence to everybody? And please keep it short because there may be a follow-up.
I'm here to argue that he has given more. He has not only given sufficient evidence, but he has given extraordinary evidence. And the claim that extraordinary evidence demands extraordinary claims, I would just ask you this. Do you know of any other quote-unquote dying, rising God that even would attempt to offer the kind of evidence in a courtroom that could find them guilty of existing? Motive, yeah. Means, etc.
You haven't demonstrated that this God exists or has the means. You just begin with the, if God exists, then this all makes sense. And there are other things that might make sense as well. And you haven't shown why we should exclude those. But that's my time.
All right. Thank you guys so much. Eric, you now have 15 minutes to cross-examine Matt.
Thank you, Matt. Can you name one of my opening premises that is more probably false than true?
No. I don't even remember all of your opening premises. But the point isn't to demonstrate.
Let me take them very quickly again, Matt, and see if you would like to point out that one of them is probably more false than true.
Sure, although I'll point out that this is an attempt to shift the burden of proof because we don't have to demonstrate that one is more probably false than true. What we're asking is whether or not these are actually
true. Let me go ahead and read these real quick, Matt. Sure. Existence does not come from non-existence. Something exists. Something is eternal. The universe is not eternal. Whatever is eternal transcends the universe. Whatever is eternal is the source of all things created. Whatever is eternal is the source of all power existing. Whatever is eternal is intelligent. Now, again, I'm going to ask the question, can you name one of those opening premises that is more probably false than true?
No, because some of them are keyed off of things that we cannot determine the probability of. When you say that the source is intelligent, I don't know how you concluded that this is more probable than not. And also this idea of the universe isn't eternal seems to be kind of a bit of playing with words, because the physics models have a non-supernatural, eternal, for example, multiverse. And while it's not our local visible universe, it is still something that is not supernatural, that you know, or that is not godly, godlike, or intelligent. But we can't determine the probability. If you don't have any demonstration that a God exists, you can't tell how probable one is. And so right now, any of the claims that hinge upon the idea that there is an intelligence outside of space-time that made decisions, I would say that the apparent probability of that is zero, because we have no examples of this actually being true. So those were the ones that I would probably...
Believe in the Big Bang?
Do I believe in the Big Bang?
Yes.
I believe that the Big Bang model is the current best explanation for the evidence that we observe.
Okay, do we have any other examples of that?
Any other examples of a Big Bang?
Yep.
No.
So in other words, you go ahead and you accept a position apart from evidence.
What I said was, I accept that this is the best current explanation. This is where the math points to. It could be wrong. It could be discovered to be wrong tomorrow. There are competing theories as well, or models that may overturn that. I'm not saying that I am absolutely convinced that the Big Bang model as it sits now is 100% accurate. In fact, I'd bet almost positively that it's not.
Okay, so again, though, the point is that you accept the idea of the Big Bang model, even though you don't have any other examples of that to support it. In other words, I'm just trying to point out, Matt, the argument that you tried to use in countering one of my premises that there was something outside of the universe was that we don't have any examples of something outside of the universe. But again, what I've demonstrated in my premises and what I've demonstrated is that there has to be something that transcends the universe. And I'm simply going to leave it at that because I believe that since you have not gone ahead and demonstrated that any of the premises are incorrect, I think that the conclusion of the premises should stand.
So you think that if you shift the burden of proof and I can't prove it wrong, that the premises stand.
I have a lot of them that I need to ask you. Maybe you can ask me later here. Let me ask you this, Matt.
Mm-hmm.
How much evidence do we have to support that natural law can originate life? In other words, how many examples do we have of natural law being able to originate life or the kind of specified complexity that we see in a living cell?
I don't know how you quantify evidence in that way, but if you're asking if we've cracked and solved and come up with a model that demonstrates abiogenesis, the answer is no, we haven't yet, which is also a shifting of the burden of proof because that doesn't mean that it requires a supernatural intervention. The fact that we haven't demonstrated...
Let's do this, Matt, then. Do we have any evidence that the kind of complexity that we see in cells, this functional specified complexity that we see in cells, do we have any kind of evidence that intelligence is able to originate that same type of complexity?
Well, first of all, I'll reject the premise that it's specified because that's a poisoning of the well. Specified, implies that there's some intent or purpose here. The process by which things naturally evolve and change through natural selection does result in...
Specified saying that the arrangement of the components that are in the cell, that specific arrangement is critical to the operation of the cell. And what I'm asking is when you have a number of components, as a matter of fact, let's go ahead and go back to the quote from the audio that I played regarding the shells on the seashore. You said that when you see that type of complexity, that you would immediately recognize that there was intelligent intervention.
Yes.
And what I'm saying is, do we know of any natural law that is capable of originating that kind of complexity, Matt?
A natural law? See, this is what I don't get. This is the process of evolution. So this ability to recognize the intelligence of the I love you things is not the same as when you talk about the functional aspects of the cell, because we recognize design by contrasting it with that which naturally occurs. We have no evidence that I love you naturally occurs in this particular formation on its own.
When it comes to I want to tell you, I actually think that your argument regarding how we recognize design is profound. I love it. I agree with it. So let me ask you this.
Why are you asking this question when clearly when it comes to the cell, we're talking about something that's natural?
Yes, questions here, Matt. Here's my point. What, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, you state that the way that we determine if something is designed is by watching nature to see if it's capable of doing it. And if we don't see it in nature, if we see a complexity that nature is not capable of doing, then we have strong reason to believe that it was intelligently designed. Did I basically summarize that correctly?
No, you didn't.
Okay, you go ahead and summarize it as quickly
as you can. So we recognize design by contrast with nature, and we evaluate all the evidence. If there is overwhelming evidence that we have plenty of examples of something actually being designed, and little or no evidence that this thing occurs naturally, then the most reasonable conclusion is that it was designed. If, however, we have overwhelming evidence that this thing occurs naturally, which is the case for the cells and biology and all of these things, I mean, that's nature by definition, and no evidence of it actually being created, I mean, I'm not aware of anybody actually building a cell from scratch, then the reasonable conclusion is that it occurred naturally. And
okay, Matt, I appreciate the explanation there. And I think that you did it as clear as could be done. So let me ask you this, though. When you say we see cells naturally being formed in nature, here's the problem, Matt. When you talk about seeing a cell naturally formed, you're referring to something that is being formed by something that is already functionally specified complex. Let's go ahead and jump to any other planet in the universe that does not have life. This is what I want to ask you, Matt.
Okay.
On any of these other planets, do you know of any natural law that is capable of going ahead and putting together that message with those seashells in that arrangement that you talked about earlier in the video?
No.
Okay. So in other words, what you're saying is that in all of the universe, we absolutely should not expect life to ever originate, because it's impossible for natural law to go ahead and originate specified complexity.
No, that's not even remotely what I was saying. I'm saying I don't have any evidence that there's intelligent life or any other mechanism out there that could spell this out in such a way that it'd be a reasonable conclusion that it's natural. That doesn't mean your conclusion doesn't follow from what I actually said.
Okay, Matt, let me make myself more clear. I'm sorry. Okay. What I'm saying, I think you will agree that intelligence is a sufficient cause to be able to arrange the seashells into a pattern that says, I love you, Matt. Okay? I think you'll agree with that. The question is, do we know of any natural law that is capable of doing it? Because my premises, the point behind my premises is to show that the only known cause capable of originating specified complexity is intelligence. Therefore, when you put all the premises together, what it shows you is that this eternal, transcendent source of all creation that is powerful is also intelligent, and it shows that based upon the evidence. And so your position, if I'm not misunderstanding you, you've testified that on any other planet, we cannot expect natural law to be able to produce the kind of message that you saw in the seashells. Well, clearly, we have that kind of complexity in the DNA of every single cell that there is.
Yep. Okay, so first of all, what I said was I don't have the information that would make it reasonable to conclude that. But when you talked about this, you talked about intelligence being sufficient. There's two components to causality in that realm, and that's sufficient and necessary. And you haven't in any way demonstrated that it's necessary, and that is the key thing that you're actually hinging on. Of course,
I agree, that's an excellent point, but I do believe that I have demonstrated that it is necessary to the extent of this. Unless you were able to go ahead and offer any other cause sufficient to be able to produce intelligence, then we are left solely with one cause, and so therefore that is the necessary cause when there is no other cause. So no. Do you have another cause capable of originating specified complexity apart from intelligence?
Yeah, so this is an argument from ignorance, and the other aspect of this that's a problem is that the only intelligence we know of exists in the universe. There's no reason to think, and it isn't even a coherent thought to think that there's an intelligence outside, and there's no reason.
That is not answering the question. The premise says that the only known cause capable of producing specified complexity is intelligence. So basically,
rejected your claim that it was specified.
What I'm hearing is that we only know of one cause. So here's my question, Matt. The question of the debate is it rational to believe that the God of the Bible exists? If my premises hold, which apparently they do, because you've not attempted to refute any of them, and you seem to even indicate that intelligence is a sufficient cause, and we know of no other cause, so if we're going to base a position on evidence, Matt, doesn't it mean that it's more rational to believe that the cause of the kind of complexity that we see in a cell is due to intelligence, other than going ahead and being what you might call religious and having a blind faith that someday we might find another cause? Is it possible that you might reject the cause, Matt, just because you don't like where it leads?
No, actually. First of all, this isn't about complexity. Complexity is not the hallmark of design. Simplicity is. And as I pointed out earlier on, my only goal was to prove that I was correct and lead other people to Jesus. I didn't reject it because I had some problem with God. But since you already think I'm a liar, you can just continue on down that road.
Okay, Matt.
Eric, you have 2 minutes.
Okay.
I'm gonna pause the timer for just a second, Eric. I just wanna state, although that it is your time and you do have the right to interrupt and re-question, I would ask that if you challenge Matt with a question or you're directing it toward him, go ahead and try to let him finish his answer. And if he does go on too long, I'll stop him and give you a chance to respond. Because I'm getting the feeling that he's only getting out. You'll ask a 2 or 3 part question.
All
right.
And
he's getting to respond to the first section of it, and then you interrupt him, and he never gets to address the rest of it. So either keep the questions to single part questions so that he can have a quick response, or allow him the opportunity to finish. Okay.
I will say that there's good for reason.
If I was doing that, Matt.
I will say that there's good reason to do that, and I don't have any objection to what he's doing.
Okay. All right. Okay, you may continue. You have 2 minutes and 4 seconds.
Okay, Matt, Dawkins, Krauss, Sam Harris, Dan Barker all agree that free will is an impossibility under physicalism. Do you agree with them?
I don't know. I generally read Sam's book on free will, and I have a difficult time disagreeing with him. Generally, I've identified as a compatibilist along the lines with Dennett. But also, listening to the physicists, we don't live in a purely deterministic universe, so there's, obviously quantum fluctuations. Nobody thinks that that's really a sufficient justification for choice. But do I think that free will is probably illusory? Yes.
Okay. So then, if free will is illusory, as your friend Dan Barker agrees with you, then basically, would you not agree that moral culpability does not exist?
No.
Not moral truths, moral culpability. No. Can you explain to me how moral culpability could exist in a world where free will does not exist?
Sure, it's a matter of practical necessity that this particular thinking agent did something that affected other people, whether I had free will to do it, whether it was whether I didn't have free will, doesn't change the fact that something has happened and now we must need to address it, and that the thing that happened,
I'm short on time here, and I don't mean to interrupt, but here's the thing. Moral culpability means that the person was to blame for what happened, that you, in looking at that person, you can actually look and ascribe to a person that what they did was evil, okay, and that they were morally culpable. Yeah. And so in the same way, if free will does not exist, how can you find somebody culpable for carrying out an action when they had no other choice? That would be like me holding a gun in my hand and you forcing me by some means, you go ahead and force me to pull the trigger to shoot somebody. According to your position, that person, if somebody did that, you could never hold that person responsible, and I agree. But my question is, how could you hold anybody ever responsible for anything if free will does not exist?
Okay, Eric, your time ran out about 10 seconds ago. I went ahead and let you wrap up your question. I'll leave it up to you. Would you like Matt to take a few moments to respond to that?
Okay,
Matt, go ahead. I'll give you about 30 seconds to respond.
I just find it frustrating to have people agree to my position when it's not my position and when I just explained. So in much the same way that when my car breaks down, we're looking for the actual cause. And if it's a part of the car that is the cause of this, then the car is quote-unquote responsible. There's a difference between somebody putting a gun in your hand and pulling the trigger. This is another agent actively moving you towards something while you are resisting. And so it's an entirely different scope. The only thing that I'm talking about is that to the extent that I have done something, whether I chose to do it as an act of free will or not, and that's clearly up for debate, I can, as a matter of practicality, and should, as a matter of practicality, be the individual who is held responsible for it. And if somebody held your finger and fired a gun in your hand, they would be the ones that are held responsible.
All right, coming up next, we are taking your questions. We've already got a caller on hold that beat you to it. So that caller, if you're online, you can hear me. We're going to get to your question after the break. We've also got several questions coming in on Twitter. The final 30 minutes of the debate before the closing remarks coming up next right here on Dogma Debate.
Now it's time for an AtheistAudiobooks.com sneak preview.
The happy atheist. Disproving Christianity.
After faith.
Our constitution.
Baptized atheists.
The God virus.
Here is an excerpt from the Good News Club. The Christian Right's Stealth Assault on America's Children by Catherine Stewart.
This book had its beginnings in one of those events that at first seems too small to matter, until suddenly it becomes too big to ignore. When a program called the Good News Club showed up on a roster of after-school activities at my daughter's public elementary school in Santa Barbara, California, I didn't give it much thought. The club advertised itself as a non-denominational Bible study program for children of kindergarten age and older, and it required parental consent for children to participate. I soon found out, however, that the Good News Club is very different from what it appears to be. More importantly, I discovered that the club is really just one small part of a much larger story that should be of concern to anyone who cares about the future of public education, or indeed the future of secular democracy in the United States.
The Good News Club. The Christian Right's Stealth Assault on America's Children is now available on atheistaudiobooks.com.
Dear God, hope you got the letter, and I pray you can make it better down here. I don't mean a big reduction in the price of beer, but all the people that you made in your image, see them starving on their feet, 'cause they don't get enough to eat from God. Can't believe in you.
Welcome back to Dogma Debate. If you're not already signed up, or if you are a member at login.dogmadebate.com, Brandy is in the chat room taking the questions as well, and she's passing me some of the questions. Questions are also coming in through Twitter, and you can give us a call. The phone number is 214-377-1166. We've already got someone on the line, so the line is busy at the moment. As soon as you hear that person hang up, call us, 214-377-1166. Right, I'm pulling up the questions now. All right, I've got the timer set for 30 minutes. We're going to start for a question for Eric. Mark Burns on Twitter asks, Eric, God is supposedly both good and omnipotent, yet he allows evil. How do you reconcile this with cognitive dissonance?
Okay. That's an entire show to try to be able to answer that question. But briefly, let me say this. As far as God being all good and allowing evil, certainly if God has a sufficiently justified reason to allow evil, then that would not be a contradiction. But let me just say that regarding the problem from evil, I believe there is a huge failure on the part of apologists to give a biblical response to that. And basically, at this point, if you guys, you know, David, if you want to have a show on this sometime, I would certainly consider doing that. But let me just say, there's no logical contradiction in showing that if evil exists, if God has a morally justified reason for allowing it, then that is not a contradiction in God being all good. Something like a child receiving a vaccination, a parent is justified in allowing the child to go through the pain if there is a morally justifiable reason to do so.
Hey, Eric, I'll ask your permission. Is it okay with you if Matt also responds to your answer, or do you want just the question to be for you?
Oh, no, let him respond. That's fine.
Okay. Matt, go ahead.
I actually don't have that much to say on the subject. I'm not a huge fan of the problem of evil, in part because of what Eric was pointing out, and in part because I think it's often phrased wrong. I think that the real problem is this seemingly extraneous quote-unquote evil. I don't even like the actual argument should probably be better proposed as this universe that we live in, what crazy plan could God have in order for things to be the way they are? Because what people are doing is they're putting themselves in God's place and saying, how could I make the world better? And one of the arguments that I made is, you know, people who are pointing to the Bible as a moral guide, I told this church in San Antonio, I can write a better moral guide than the Bible right now, and I can prove it to everybody, because I could rewrite the Bible word for word and change it so that it doesn't support slavery, and it would already be a better moral guide. Okay. And I think that's the same thing people are seeing, is that there's this, you know, unnecessary harm that just doesn't make sense.
All right, Frederick Vold on Twitter has a question for Matt. Do you ever feel like you lost something valuable when you lost your faith?
Yeah, it's a good question. We get that a lot. And I know people who feel that way. For me, I don't. I'm sure I had some feelings along those lines at some point. But it was like, you know, the example that I've used is if I'd been told that on my 21st birthday I was going to inherit $1 billion, when I hit 21 and found out that this actually wasn't true, I would certainly feel some disappointment that this wasn't the case. But I don't tend to focus on that. There's nothing I can do about it to change it. Have I lost the prospect of heaven? Yes. Have I lost the idea of an afterlife? Yes. But I've gained so much more from it and so much value in my life that it's offset, and I really can't see any good reason to mourn things that I can't change.
Eric, any response to that?
No.
All right, we have a question for you, Eric, from one of our fourth listener members in the chat room. Iyam Tan is asking, I want to ask Eric if he thinks pain is God's megaphone, a la C.S. Lewis. And if so, why isn't he torturing as many non-Christians as possible?
Is it his megaphone?
Right.
Without a doubt, I think there's absolutely biblical precedent to believe that God will go ahead and introduce pain in various forms. It doesn't have to be just physical pain. And the reason why is because, like a megaphone, that may be the best tool to go ahead to go ahead and get somebody's attention. But as far as why doesn't he do that in every situation? Again, the question is, not why doesn't he? Because if this is the one that created the universe and brought life into existence, some of those why questions, that's like asking, having a calculator ask a computer why it responds like it does. Sometimes a calculator is not going to be able to understand all of the things that a computer might do. It's just
well,
not
I think,
part of its makeup.
I think specifically, I think the question is if God is in fact using pain as a megaphone, then the question is, why isn't he using that to torture as many non-Christians as possible? Why aren't more non-Christians suffering as to hear God's message?
Because that's not the way that God works. I mean, God uses other methods. I mean, I think it's as simple as that. Why doesn't he? I mean, does he want him to do that? He has of various means in which he speaks to his people and works things out in their life. It's an unlimited means that God uses to deal with the lives of people.
Okay. All right, we've got a caller on the line from a 989 area code. You're live on the air. What's your name?
Hi, my name's Nathan.
Hi, Nathan. Where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Michigan.
Nathan from Michigan. Go ahead with your question.
Yeah, I had a question for Eric. You just said something, that's not the way God works. Kind of something that you hear a lot. It isn't the nature of God. So my question with whether or not God can change his nature, and essentially it gets back to, is God limited to the laws of logic?
All right. Did you get the question clearly, Eric?
I think so. Regarding can God change his nature? Certainly not. Malachi 3:6. I'm the Lord God, I change not. Is he limited to the laws of logic? It's not a matter of being It's not a matter of being limited by the laws of logic. The laws of logic they simply express truth. They place no limitation on God. That's all.
All right, Nathan, thank you for the call. The lines are open, 214-377-1166, if you want to get on the air, get your question answered, or live tweet at David C. Smalley. More tweets coming in. This question for Eric: was today's argument you used constructed after you believed in God? This is from Tony Benji on Twitter.
Yes.
Okay. Matt, this question is from Barb's Wire on Twitter. Matt, you said science can't say anything about the supernatural. But if the supernatural occurs, shouldn't science be able to test it?
So we can test, this is why I talked about a God manifesting in reality. We can test the natural presentation of this, but we cannot confirm a supernatural causation. There's a barrier there. Now that doesn't mean that we couldn't eventually get to a point where we could reasonably, reach some conclusion about something, you know, that there's something unknown, etc. But for example, if God answers prayer, and we've tested this, we can't test whether or not God's actually answering prayer. What we can test is these people are praying. What are the results? Turns out they're consistent with chance, or in some cases, they're actually negative if the individual knows that they're praying about him. And so this, it's kind of like a box that you can't get into, but if you shake it around and it makes noise, that noise presents on this side of the box. Unfortunately, when we shake the box of Christianity around, I really don't see that we get any noise at all.
So your answer is, if something supernatural were to occur, science would not be able to deal with it at all anyway.
Science can investigate and confirm the manifestation, the natural manifestation, but it can't confirm that the cause was supernatural. It would just still be unknown.
Okay. Eric, we have a question
Can I respond to something that Matt said there?
Sure.
Okay, real quickly. The comments about the whole prayer thing and prayer not being answered, you know, I don't argue with the conclusions of that at all. I think that Matt, stated what the tests show clearly. But what I want you to understand that if somebody understands God and knows what the Bible teaches, that's exactly what you would expect, because the offer for God to hear and answer prayer has very specific conditions that are revealed in the Bible. If those conditions are not met, then you no more should expect to have an answer to your prayer than you should be able to expect to make a cake without flour and sugar. It doesn't happen. So if you were to go ahead and sit down with those people who were involved in that test and said, hey, listen, do you know what the conditions are upon which you ought to be able to have faith that God would answer your prayer? I am confident that there probably would not be, if there was one of them, I would be surprised. So I just want you to know that according to what the scripture shows, they actually give testimony that they should not expect there to be any difference. So anyways, that's that.
Okay, Edward Terry on Twitter has a really good question for you. He says, throughout the debate, he's speaking of you, Eric, he says, throughout the debate, Eric says, if God, then blank. The question is whether this God exists. Can you address that, Eric?
I can only address that with the evidence that I gave to demonstrate that God exists. And as I said, I do believe that the premise is, unless you're going to be shown some illogical nature to the premises, that the premises certainly went on, you know, unrefuted. So I think that I think I met the burden of proof. So when I say if God, the evidence shows that God exists.
Okay. Fourth listener in the chat room, Miles, says, how does Eric get from a God, just a God, or a creator or first cause, to specifically the God of the Bible?
Again, the reason that I do that is because I believe that there are two particular claims when you're going to go ahead and believe that it's the God of the Bible that exists. I believe that there are two miracles that are uniquely testifying that the God that exists is the God of the Bible. Those miracles are what occurred during the Exodus and at Mount Sinai, And for further research, you can examine what the internet has to say about the Khazari principle. I think that presents that argument as succinctly as possible. But then also the resurrection, because these two miracles, unlike any other type of miracles that people hear of, these have the greatest degree of verification that they actually took place. So, for example, when you go ahead and you examine what took place at Mount Sinai in the Exodus, I would challenge any person to go ahead and try to copycat the Exodus and the fact that the entire Jewish nation, who has a very clear connected history back to the time of the Exodus, go ahead and try to reconstruct another miracle where a group of people that included millions of people have come to believe that the God that they serve revealed himself to them, and the reason that they believe it is, when you go ahead and you look at the Jewish people, to try to get a group of people to believe that they actually experienced it is an impossible task, which is the reason why when the Bible points out...
Okay, Eric, let's shorten up your answer just a little bit.
In Deuteronomy, God made the claim, whatever nation has ever had a God reveal himself to him and deliver the people from another nation. What other God has done that? And the answer is, there's a lot of other miracle claims that are copycatted, people raising from the dead, people doing this, people doing that. There's a lot of them that are copycatted. The deliverance of the Israelites and the revelation of God on Mount Sinai has never been copycatted, and it because it can't be.
Matt, would you like to respond?
I think it would be too long, so let's get to more questions, and maybe I'll address it in closing.
Okay. In our fourth listener chat room, by the way, the phone lines are open again, 214-377-1166. 214-377-1166. You can call in. You will be the next caller on the air. Mick Epicurean is in the fourth listener chat room at login.dogmadebate.com. Wants to know, I'd like to ask Matt if logic or principles like Eric was using have the power or ability to demonstrate the existence of anything.
Yeah, I would say that not without supporting evidence. So one of the things is that you have to actually, a logical argument is only as good as the premises. And so what Eric had done was basically said, hey, can you show any of my premises that are more probably false than true? And well, no, because in many cases, the premises that were offered, I don't know how you would calculate that. You know, and to me, looking at it, there's a zero probability because we don't have any supporting evidence for it. So with a logical argument only being as good as the premises, then if a premise could be either true or false, and we don't know which one it is, then we should just stop right there, because necessarily true conclusions only come from true premises, and if any premise is potentially false, then the conclusion is unreliable. And so it's one of the reasons why, hey, we haven't thought of anything better, so I'm going to use this as a premise. That ultimately reaches the conclusion that a God exists is something that I find absolutely unimpressive, because you haven't actually demonstrated the truth of your premises, even if you demonstrated that they're possible or probable, which I don't see how you could do when you're including a God in your premise.
All right, since that question was directed toward Matt, but sort of at Eric, Eric, I would like you to have a chance to respond.
Thanks, David. Matt says that the premises, you cannot go ahead and demonstrate that the premises are true. I think I gave rock solid evidence that the premise is true. And if you go back and listen, I'm not going to go through them, but after making each premise, I gave evidence. And if Matt would like to go ahead and say which evidence was false and does not support the premise and demonstrate it to be true, I give him that opportunity.
Yeah, so it's not about which premise is false or which bit of evidence is false, and this is the same confusion that we had when Eric called the show, and it's an attempt to shift the burden of proof. The fact that I am not convinced that a premise is true does not mean that I am convinced it's false, and does not mean that I can demonstrate that it's false. The fact that Eric thinks he's given rock-solid evidence is, frankly, unimpressive.
Can you just tell me one that I did not give proof that it's true? One where the proof is not sufficient.
Well, I definitely don't think that you gave sufficient proof that there needs to be some thinking agent as the cause, that it's impossible for there to be a naturalistic cause.
Okay, Matt, I multiple times gave you the opportunity to answer the question, is natural law capable of producing specified complexity? Do we have evidence that it can? You said over and over and over again that it does. There is no evidence, and you also said there is evidence that intelligence can do it. So is there another premise that you think that the evidence that I presented is not sufficient?
Yeah, so there's just another shifting of the burden of proof argument from ignorance. Matt can't prove it wrong, which completely avoids what I just said, which is the fact that I'm not convinced it's true doesn't mean that I'm convinced that it's false and doesn't mean I can demonstrate it's false. I don't know how much clearer I can explain that.
Okay. Guys, I'm going to move on to the next question. Paleo Clipper has asked on Twitter. This question, it says for mostly Eric, but they would like a response from Matt as well. The early church took images of the pagan god Pan and told people that they were images of Satan. How do you feel about rewriting history like that?
I don't really, I mean, I don't know how to respond to that. I mean, they if they did it, they did it. I mean, is it, you know, it's a false god, it's a lie. I don't really, if you want to clarify to me, David, maybe what this person is looking for in an answer, I don't really know how that relates to what I'm discussing here is the problem.
I think the question is early church behavior. If they, in fact, rewrote history by not being completely honest about specific things or perhaps what Satan may have looked like, do you endorse that? Are you okay with early church not being so truthful about history?
Well, I don't really know how that pertains to the arguments that I presented, except in one case, this is what I would like to say to, you know, all the listeners, and that is, if you're looking for the strongest arguments for the veracity, the trustworthiness of the scriptures, the thing that I believe produces the strongest evidence that it was eyewitness accounts and that they're trustworthy, without exception, it's undesigned scriptural coincidences by J.J. Blunt and also Jorge Pauline by William Paley, the designer of the watch argument. You can go to YouTube and you can punch in Tim McGrew, and he has numerous videos on this. I think these are the strongest arguments for the veracity of the New Testament scriptures. And as far as changing the truth, obviously, I would always be against that.
Okay, Peter Craig on Twitter has a question for Eric. Sorry to leave you out so much, Matt. Peter Craig says, does Eric have evidence of something existing outside of space and time? Not a claim, not a verse, but evidence.
Absolutely. The evidence clearly shows, just from my premises, existence does not come from non-existence. We know something exists. That means something has to be eternal. Otherwise, existence came from non-existence. We know that it's not the universe. So logically, and this, I believe, is the very kind of evidence that leads even Lawrence Krauss to be more inclined to accept a multiverse, because these are logical premises that are irrefutable. And so is there evidence that something transcends the universe? I believe absolutely yes. I believe it's utterly impossible for there not to be something that transcends the universe. So if these premises are true, then I think the case holds.
Matt?
Yeah, and my objection is probably the same one that Krauss had. Which is, I don't see any justification for claiming that whatever it is that transcends the universe is necessarily intelligent, or that it, you know, has the properties and characteristics that Eric would say that it does.
All right, Eric, this is an interesting one. I think you will enjoy it because it will give you a moment to speak here. Is Ray, I hope I'm saying that right, or Rye, in the fourth listener chat room at login.dogmadebate.com is asking, Eric, can you demonstrate the truth of your premise one instead of just asserting it's true or pointing to intuition?
Absolutely. David, I don't know where you're at. Are you in a studio, or let's just go ahead and suppose this. Wherever you're at, let's just suppose that a fire broke out in that room, and the premise, as I have stated it, is existence does not come from non-existence. So, if we go ahead and say that this fire occurred and somebody asks, you know, how did this fire occur? And I say, this fire began to exist from nothing. Well, would not every single person agree that such a thought is absurd? So, you know, the fact that you can have an event take place, and when somebody asks, oh, what caused it? I don't think there's a person on the planet that if somebody said, oh, that fire that began to exist, it came from nothing. Every single one of us, we have a self-awareness that that is utter foolishness, because we know that nothing can begin to exist. Nothing can begin to exist coming from non-existence.
All right, I will move on to Keith.
Jump in?
Sure. Oh, yeah, that's right. Go ahead.
So Eric and I aren't vastly far apart here, just in the same way that, you know, Krause and he aren't very far apart here. But the thing about nothing in this strict, literal, you know, non-existence, it has no properties. You can't act upon it. And intuitively, it wouldn't appear that it can actually do anything. It may even be the case, and this kind of makes sense to me, that nothing, a pure nothing, non-existence, simply cannot, I mean, well, obviously it can't exist, that's a contradiction, but that there is no nothing anywhere and could never be. You know, linguistically we have a problem with this. But if there was, in this strange hypothetical, that if there was a nothing, a something, it would still be a something, you can't even talk about it without jumping in there. The important thing is that we can't examine it and can't say what it can or can't do. And the problem with the language is that even trying to talk about it by referring to it as it's already something. And so traveling down this road, it's just much easier to say, okay, you know, we understand causality to some extent. The problem here is that as Sean Carroll pointed out when debating William and Craig the other day, the general idea that people have about causality with regard to nothings and universes simply breaks down. And we have a better understanding from physics.
Okay, guys, I've got three more questions that are really, really good, and we're running up on less than 5 minutes. So I'm going to go ahead and move forward. Keith Kalura on Twitter says, Eric says Romans 1 is fact. The Quran says Muhammad was the last prophet. How do we distinguish which is true?
Again, I would say let the Muslim go ahead and try to give a courtroom procedure where they're going to demonstrate, they're going to go ahead and find Muhammad guilty of being the prophet of God, because one of the things, again, that is the difference with Christianity is I demonstrated that we have means, we have the fact that the God of the Bible clearly said that he was going to send the Messiah, that this Messiah would institute a new covenant, that this Messiah not only would die, Isaiah 3 and Daniel chapter 9, but that this Messiah would reign forever, which demands a physical resurrection. If he's going to die, but yet he's going to rule forever, has to be raised. We have the confession of Christ that he would die and be raised from the dead. We have the motive. Jesus himself said that he came to die as a ransom for the world. We have the eyewitness testimony. We have the testimony of the opponents of the Jews. They have consistently testified to his life, okay, death, crucifixion, and burial. If you were to go ahead and ask for somebody to give those kinds of evidences for Muhammad, what was the motive? Was there an entire religion that had to be fulfilled as a result of his coming?
Okay, thanks, Eric. I think we get it. Matt?
Okay. You can go on. I'll hit it in the closing.
Okay. I think this one is directed for Eric as well. Matt, I don't believe you would have anything to say to this. It sounds like a question you may ask. Eric, let's see. Aaron Hubler on Twitter is asking, why is God called a he in the Bible if he doesn't have a human body, not counting Jesus who came later?
Well, I guess we could ask the question. Well, first of all, the position of he has certainly the patriarchal sense that I mean, he reveals himself as a father, but there are also times when God certainly reveals that he has what you would refer to as the feminine characteristics in regards to caring for his people like a mother. And as far as why do we refer to him as a he, maybe your caller has a suggestion as to how else he could have referred to himself. I mean, he called himself God. I think for convenience sake, clearly, God does not possess, you know, the physical anatomy of a male, but the position that he has is certainly as the, you would refer to him as the head of the universe, and that plays into creation. So I don't think that affects anything as far as God's existence.
And I'd just like to add in that maybe at some point Eric and I can have a long conversation about how comments like Sissy and the gender normative assumptions about the roles of mothers and fathers aren't necessarily the best way to talk about things, but okay.
Okay, and the last question, more than likely last question, if both of you have a chance to respond, is from Red on Twitter. The question for Eric, is a God that condones slavery and treating women as spoils of war a God worth worshiping?
Well, again, this goes into the whole debate of morality and biblical morality, and certainly this is a discussion that we would need to have an entire show to go ahead and answer this question. And I'm glad to go ahead and do that, because honestly, there's so much false information about that whole subject, so many things that people do not consider, because you have to take into account things that go far deeper than I have the time to explain right now, but I'm happy to do that. So, David, if you want to do it, I will gladly do it at another time.
Okay, and there is one more question I want to get to. So, Matt, did you have anything to get to really quickly? We've got about 1 minute left, but I want to fit this last question.
Yeah, go.
Okay, this last question is from Bob Bull in the fourth listener chat room at login.dogmadebate.com. Eric, how do you get the free pass on a God not having a cause, yet you assert everything else requires a cause?
First of all, I did not demonstrate that everything else needed a cause. Anything eternal. Let's just suppose that we didn't have evidence that whatever existed possessed intelligence. Then we would simply have an eternal, transcendent, all-powerful source of all creation. And therefore, if there was an eternal universe, that eternal universe would not need a cause. So it's not a matter of getting a pass. Anything that is eternal would not need a cause. So we've demonstrated that God is eternal. So therefore, anything eternal would not need a cause. So it's not a matter of getting a pass. The only thing that needs a cause is an effect that occurs in, you know, an effect that begins. Anything eternal does not need a cause. That would, again, in my last discussion on your show, David, I brought out the illustration of if somebody had a cup, that cup was an eternal cup, and somebody said, oh, where did the cup come from? Well, the cup didn't come from anywhere. It's eternal. We know that something is eternal. It just happens that it's God.
Okay,
and
so let me,
anything eternal doesn't need a cause.
Let me slightly rephrase it just for the listeners. Okay. Rather than it being eternal, how about something intelligent? If your claim is that everything with intelligence requires an intelligent designer, if God being something intelligent, why does he not need a designer?
Well, the argument, remember, the argument is this, that intelligence is the only thing capable of originating specified complexity. Well, since you have, when you have an eternal God, there is nothing, there is no point in time where this intelligence began. Okay. So, therefore, I mean, he's an eternal being. So he doesn't, the intelligence isn't needed because he eternally has forever, the nature of God does not change.
Okay,
that's been demonstrated.
We're way over. I was doing that for the benefit of the listener because I wanted the spirit of the question to come through. Matt, if you want 30 seconds to respond to that, I'll give that to you before we break and get into the final closing remarks.
Sure. Eric just said that intelligence is the only thing capable of specified complexity, which is a departure from the previous discussion, which is the only thing that he knows of, although I would agree that we do know of other things in the sense that the complexity he's talking about seems to be caused purely naturally. I think it's, you know, I guess the follow-up question, which we're not going to have time to address, is whether or not God has any specified complexity. I understand and agree that something eternal doesn't have a cause, but this question of whether God has specified complexity, and if intelligence is, as Eric says, the only thing capable of that, I think there's a little, maybe it's a linguistic problem, but it's definitely still a problem.
All right. Well, coming up next, each will have five minute closing statement. Wrapping it up on Dogma Debate right after this.
Now it's time for an AtheistAudiobooks.com sneak preview.
The happy atheist disproving Christianity after faith.
Our Constitution.
Baptized atheists.
The God Finals.
Here is an excerpt from The Child Catchers, Rescue, Trafficking, and the New Gospel of Adoption by Catherine Joyce.
That's when the pressure turned ugly. The musics sat her down, Rianne said, and asked her what her plan to parent was. In a letter she wrote later, she listed the arguments the musics made. That placing your child for adoption was biblical, so God would bless me abundantly for my decision. That I had too much potential to be a single mother, and God had big plans for me. That they had to hold me to what I said when I first moved in. And finally, that it shows you care more for your child when you place them for adoption. Rianne didn't know that consent documents for adoption are not legally binding in Washington State until after birth. Everything was screaming at me to keep my child, Rianne said. Rianne wrote the Butler's pastor to request that he help mediate some agreement with the family. The social worker called the Butlers and returned to Rianne with a message. They didn't want an open adoption or to send any photos, but they said to tell you, thank you for the gift.
The Child Catchers, now available at atheistaudiobooks.com.
I'm Lalandra, and I'm actually the fourth listener.
I want to remind the listeners to go to recoveringfromreligion.org. If you want to sign up for a live debate, Matt Dillahunty versus Cy Ten Brugenkate, it is in Memphis, Tennessee, Saturday, May 31st. Yours truly will be there. I'll be giving a presentation just before the debate on loving your enemy, how we can all still love each other, even though we may not agree on our worldviews. And there will also be a live broadcast of Dogma Debate from the after party, or just after the after party, right there in Memphis, Tennessee. So it's Cy Ten Brugenkate versus Matt Dillahunty. Everything's available at recoveringfromreligion.org. I want to thank you guys both for coming out, for doing this, for showing up and making this happen, and most of all, for staying as civil as you possibly can. I think it's been very educational, very informative, but I know that we've addressed a lot of things. So you each have 5 minutes to wrap it up, say what you want to leave the listener with as your final comment. Eric, you go first. You have 5 minutes.
Thank you, David. And I will go ahead and take just a couple moments here to tell you that I really do appreciate the fact that you moderated today's debate. And Matt, I certainly appreciate that you were willing to go ahead and appear on the program with a guy who only has 34 followers on Twitter. And I also appreciate the comments that you made regarding that email. I would like to say that also regarding the comment earlier about the sissy atheist, I certainly did not intend for that to be offensive. I was simply trying to relate the relative actions of today's atheist with Paul, because, you know, yes, we've got guys like you, David, and you, Matt, that will go ahead and participate in debates and try to convince others that Jesus is not the Messiah, But we certainly don't have anybody even close to trying to, actively, who's an active agent in trying to destroy Christians. I mean, in some countries, there are people who are trying to do that. As a matter of fact, I have a friend that has been in prison for quite some time over in Iran because he tried to start house churches, and he's been over in prison for well over a year now and away from his wife and kids, and he's been beat and had to endure torture. And the last I knew, he was receiving at least some type of attention in the hospital. But again, my point was that the Apostle Paul was literally spent every single moment prior to his conversion doing everything he could to try to destroy Christians and have them taken away and even put to death. So again, I apologize if that the term came across in a way I certainly did not intend it. Next, as far as the evidence that I gave today regarding the existence of God, I would like for every one of the listeners to go back through and listen very closely, because I think that what you're going to notice, and I don't think there's any dispute about this, that Matt did not refute any of the evidence. As a matter of fact, time and time again, to Matt's credit, he responded truthfully about the evidence and even said that he was not able to show that the premises were false, which is unusual for an atheist to actually do that. And then even when it came to the points that I made about the suppressing life of an atheist, if you go back and listen to Matt, you know, he seems to say that regarding the whole idea of being hardwired to believe that that does take place, even in, and I'm going to try to find that clip where you actually say it, Matt, but you even seem to go ahead and try to state that you do feel that way, that there is something, but you believe it's of evolutionary origin. And I appreciate the fact that you said you feel like you do have a free will, but that the evidence seems to indicate that you don't. So my point is that time and time again, the evidence that I submitted, if you go back and were to write down the evidence and put Matt's refutation of it, I don't think you'd write many refutations. I think in most cases he agreed with it. So my hope is that instead of going ahead and continuing for Christians to be represented as people who believe something apart from evidence, my attempt today was to demonstrate that what I believe is based upon the evidence. And I wanted to go back to one thing that a caller stated, a question that he asked. He said, did I know the premises before I believed?
You have 60 seconds, Eric.
I did not know the premises as far as actually to write them down. However, the truth of each one of the premises was something that was manifested automatically from just like what it says in Romans, that everything that I saw testified to the attributes and the existence of God. And I hope the things that I have said today will convince you people of that also. And by you people, I mean you listeners. I'm not referring to any one particular group. That's all, Matt. And David, thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, Eric. Matt, you have 5 minutes for your closing statements.
Helps if I turn on my mic. So I'm assuming you can hear me now. So there are really kind of four things that I want to touch on about what happened in this debate with Eric. And number one is he's trying to make the case that the God proposition is consistent with what we see. This is unimpressive because something that can do anything is consistent with everything. There's been no demonstration of truth. There's just been, hey, this is consistent and this works. And there's a whole lot of if God then. The second thing was that when asked what would change his mind, he said nothing. No other God explanation is possible. No other non-God explanation is possible. No new information. For someone trying to claim a scientific foundation and a rational foundation for their beliefs, that's perhaps the most unscientific thing I think we could hear. The third point is this protective measure. There's many protective measures that religions have built in, but one of them is this idea that those who disagree are lying or deceived or, you know, tools of Satan, or, you know, we've heard it all, not necessarily here today, but over the course of many years. And this is tied to the second complaint, that nothing would change his mind. It's a way of protecting beliefs from scrutiny. When you see the apparent contradiction between Romans 1, where God has written this truth on everybody's heart, and then you meet people who say that they haven't had that written on their heart, when you meet tribes of people in the Amazon who have no clue about this supposedly revealed truth at all, we can just say that they're lying, or they're suppressing their truth, or they've been denied by Satan. And the second protective measure along with this is, well, you haven't proved me wrong. You haven't demonstrated a method better than the one that I proposed. I offered up these premises, and you didn't refute them. You know, you couldn't offer a better explanation. And this "you couldn't offer a better explanation" is an argument from ignorance fallacy. And the fourth thing is that Eric believes the Bible account. Despite, you know, there were a lot of assertion of facts. The Exodus is fact. No, it's not. Paul's account is fact. No, it's not. The resurrection is fact. No, it's not. I mean, if you can assert it without backing it up, I can reject it without backing it up. There's no contemporary extra-biblical support for the claims. The Gospels almost certainly weren't written by eyewitnesses. They weren't even written around the time of eyewitnesses generally. But it doesn't matter, because you can talk to real-life people who will give you their eyewitness account of alien abduction scenario, and we don't necessarily believe them either, even though they're right here. You know, when we're talking about something that happened thousands of years ago that's reported in a book, and you're just going to say, oh, I believe the biblical account. And why? Because we have the means. If we were in the court, we have the means. No, we don't have the means. The debate is about the means, the capability. Does a God actually exist who could do this? If you just keep saying, if God, then we have the means, in a debate about whether God, the debate is about whether we have the means. He pointed out that we couldn't copy the miracles of the Bible, try to copycat the Exodus. Well, I could copycat the Exodus, because the only thing that we have for the Exodus is an account in a book. And I could write a copycat account in a book. We can reconstruct the claim, because that's all we have. The evidence for the Exodus simply isn't there. And the story is preposterous, as I've pointed out in other videos. This last thing, or one of the last couple of things I wanted to touch on, one was this idea of the moral argument, which we didn't hit in great detail, but we talked about free will and holding people accountable, and this idea that, you know, there's a moral code from God. Almost every single version of the moral argument, including this one, has hidden within it an appeal to consequences. Hey, if there is no God, you have no ultimate source for morality. Okay? So what? If there are no market pixies, we have no ultimate source for how much a pencil is worth. And yet, curiously, that doesn't stop us from buying and selling pencils. And it doesn't mean that somebody could claim a pencil is worth $5 billion and it just is so. This is about appealing to reality, and morality is much the same. The last thing is that he said, I offered no refutations. Well, he had the burden of proof. I can't refute if God then. I can't refute you're suppressing the truth. I can't refute I believe the miracle accounts of the Bible are accurately reported. I can't refute this is the most probable explanation when there's no way to measure the probability of that explanation other than to point out that I don't agree, that he hasn't met this burden, that I don't know how he could even determine that this is the most probable answer. And so, are we rationally justified? Is there sufficient evidence to believe in the God in the Bible? Not only do I not think that that's the case, I don't think that there's sufficient evidence to believe that there are any gods.
All right, thank you guys so much. I definitely appreciate your time coming out and doing this today, and I think you both did a very good job. So Eric Lounsbury, Matt Dillahunty, ladies and gentlemen. The fans love you guys. Thanks so much for being a part of this. I do, as I do every show, always thank our premium supporters for making this happen. The Atheist Experience TV show, definitely Google that. Check it out. There's stuff all over YouTube, but also Atheist Community of Austin. We'd like to thank everybody for their support in the movement and what they're doing. And for those that found Eric convincing and that would like to find out more information, Eric, is there a website or Twitter feed that they can follow you on?
They can certainly go ahead and go to my Twitter and message me there. Then I also have some stuff available on sermonaudio.com.
And follow him.
They can download.
What's that, Matt?
On Twitter so that nobody can ever claim he only has 34 followers again.
Yeah, go follow him. Everybody go follow Eric Lounsbury on Twitter.
Thanks, Matt.
All right, I want to move forward with thanking our premium supporters who make this show happen. Thank you guys so much. Matt, thank you to Eric. You guys are more than welcome to go, and certainly appreciate your time today.
Thanks, David. Thanks, Eric. Appreciate it.
Thanks, David. Thanks, Matt. Bye.
Thank you. The premium supporters who make this show possible, J.D. Minges, John Hembry, Robin Bell, Vishal Masish, John Payden, Eric Balaj, John Sebastian Matt, Jacob Grosek, Travis McGee, Robert Button, Yesh Medicinebird, Paul Hudson, Matt Hiller, Jack Philbin, Stacy Frederick, Tom Amon, Michael Perez, Francis Wicks, Michelle Wickham, Paul Svensson, Randall Hogan, Paleo Clipper, Randall Phillips, Eric Carell, Steve Johnson, Robert Bob Bull, Jonathan Collins, Charles Proteau, Brad Parker, Michael Epson, Alexander Dabney, Rich. That name is just like Madonna. It's just Rich. Jeffrey Strucka, Winston Jin, Rizzotto, Anik, Bill Bishop, Jonathan Straw, and Donnie Ray Bailey Reed. Thank you guys so much for the support. Up until Friday, April 18th, if you sign up to be a premium supporter on login.dogmadebate.com, you not only get your name said on the air if you so choose, you get a lot of other stuff, including a free audiobook as long as you sign up by Friday, April 18th to become a premium supporter. Plus, and premium supporters get to see video inside the studio, and often when we have guests, like we just had Matt Dillahunty on, you also get to see video of those folks. We've got some videos of Lawrence Krauss, we've got Dan Barker, all the archive footage is available to you. Login.dogmadebate.com, and remember, those premium supporters do get a free audiobook until Friday, April 18th. There will not be a show this coming Wednesday because we will be leaving and heading to Utah, Salt Lake City to be exact, for the American Atheist Convention, where we're going to be doing a live broadcast there. It looks like Friday and Saturday, both at Live Dogma Debate, to the best of our little fragile abilities. Until then, the conversation continues at dogmadebate.com and facebook.com/dogmadebate. Keep the conversation going. Treat each other with respect. Be peaceful. Love you guys so much. Thanks for supporting the show. Thank you to Brandy for helping in the chat room and all your support as outreach director. You can follow me on Twitter @DavidCSmalley. See you guys later.